from long-term perspectives. So there was debate throughout the world that we must reform the idea of, we must remodel the idea of development. The development must be eco-friendly, the development must be people-friendly, and also we should have to pay some, futuristic perspective to development. The development which does not do much harm to environment and do justice to all sections of people, and also it ensures the survival of our future generation only. That kind of development is the real development, and people used to call it sustainable development. Dr. Shoykia referred to all these things in his inaugural address. Therefore, I do not like to explain all these things. But one thing we find that the development model, the global development model, then the regional development models, local development models, there is a big difference. No doubt, the entire humanity must have a global level model of development, no doubt. And we shall have to follow that. And you know that all the countries of the world, all scientists, all social scientists, everybody actually took part in developing a concept, a global model. That is the model of sustainable development. Sustainable development has a philosophy. It has a science behind. And it has a legal kind of component also. So sustainable development is an all-round development. And it is for the people, by the people, and also for the sustenance of the nation system, sustenance of the environmental system. So therefore, at the global level, there are some models must be there, because we have some global problem. Climate change is a global problem. Then emission of carbon dioxide throughout the world, leading to concentration of more carbon dioxide in the atmosphere is a global problem. So in that way, some global level problems are there. So we must have a global level model of development. Then, as you all know, that some regional contexts are there, because environment varies from area to area. So within the country, sometimes you will find different contexts, different national contexts, different social contexts, and to suit this, local or regional context, we must also be able to develop some, some model, regional model. Take, for example, Northeast. Northeast is unique. We have 7 states, and we belong to the entire Northeast plains and hills. We belong to the Eastern Himalaya, the part of the Eastern Himalaya. So we have a different ecological history, a different social history, and also we have a different economic history. And our context, our contents, and our prospects for development is something different from other areas. Therefore, within the national framework, for example, Indian national framework, we should also have a regional framework for Northeast, and we must be able to develop a development framework which will pay respect, required respect to nature, respect to human culture, human society, and also pay sufficient attention, adequate attention to the future demands, future need of the people. So in that way, we should have to develop a model for our region. Now we find recently it was referred to by Dr. Shoykia also. We had a problem here. We had problem of coal mining. We had problem of the natural gas leakage and all that. Also we have a problem of, although it was very helpful for our regional economy, the tea gardens, for example, but historically, if you see, then all these were actually introduced by the British. Their interest was completely different, but now we are continuing all these things. Mining is, continuing. Then we have the oil explorations, exploration of gases, extraction of gases, and all these things, and also we have the tea gardens, the big tea gardens we already have, and also we have large number of small tea gardens. But then at this moment, in the context of Northeast, in the present context, if we see, then we should be very, very careful. So all these, kind of exploitation of resources, for example, tea gardens. Tea garden means, if there is vegetal diversity, plant diversity in a particular area, that diversity will be disturbed by introducing a tea garden. Tea garden means we shall be interested in only single species plant, that tea and some shade trees, but we will not pay any interest to other plants. And therefore we find a tea garden, no doubt, I don't say that tea gardens are bad, but then tea gardens are good economically, but then we must be careful that a tea garden means actually a great pressure on the local ecosystem. For example, the tea garden, the land occupied by the tea garden, in that area, a large number of, forest tree species, all these things were there. But when it is replaced by tea, then we reduce the number of species, both plants and animals. So the tea plantation, then they take, for example, the coal mining. Coal mining is a big problem. Then also this extraction of gases and all that, many problems are associated with. So now we must be very careful because we have very little green cover. Already the wetlands, then rivers, if you see, then all these are highly degraded, degraded in quality, degraded in size and all that. And therefore we cannot allow further degradation of these, these environmental elements. We must be very, very careful. So for disaster is concerned, for example, Dr. Shoikia referred to the man-made disaster as well as natural disaster. I find, and globally also, there are discussions that many of the disasters or hazards, we call natural, but they are not basically natural, but there is human contribution. We cannot say that flood is a natural hazard. Now, 100 years back, it was so. But now, if you see the flooding in the Brahmaputra Valley or Barak Valley, then you will find that human contribution is much more. Take, for example, even in the pre-monsoon period and the beginning of the monsoon period also, we have flood. But if you see the genesis of this flood, then you will find it is not rainwater alone, but because of some human interferences in the natural system. In Bhutan, as well as Arunachal Pradesh and all that, and also in Nagaland, we have some water management system, hydel project system, for example. They are actually disturbing the water flow and creating, sometimes a flood here and there, untimely flood, for example. So now take, for example, therefore, flood is no longer a completely natural hazard. Even earthquake, if you see the impacts or effects of earthquake, then also you will find that earthquake is no longer a natural hazard, but its impact, for example, if you see, then you will find the human interference is very much, accountable. Take, for example, in Northeast India, we had two very big earthquakes. In 1897, then in 1950, and you see that the casualty was very low, few hundred only. But if, for example, today, if there is a earthquake of that magnitude, then casualty may be much more, then the damage may be much more, because we have intensely humanized the landscapes, intensely humanized the environment, and therefore any any disaster or any events, natural events, for example, like earthquake, flood and all that, will cause more problem, because everywhere we find the human occupants, human spread of human activities and all that. Take, for example, the chronically flood affected floodplain of the Brahmaputra River. That was free from human settlements. That means what? From the Brahmaputra. Brahmaputra now is a very big river, very wide, and the weight of the Brahmaputra River is increasing and increasing. The average wide of the river is now about 8 kilometers. Somewhere it is maybe 12, 15 kilometer. And we find a very closely associated floodplain, from Sodia to Dhubri. And the floodplain is also very, very wide. And that active floodplain where chronically there is flood, every year there is flood. And that area was actually not settled by human being, but now we find that so many human population is there. Therefore, that area which is affected by flood every year, so that is now occupied by human activities, human beings, settlements are there. Therefore, human damage of flood will be much more there. There was no human being, no activity. Therefore, damage caused by flood was very little there in that active floodplain area. But now it is much more. In that way, you know that the response of human society to environment, it is not eco-friendly. It is not environment friendly. And most cases, people are going against the natural principles, natural laws, natural systems, causing a lot of problem. We must be able to clearly understand the natural system, how nature is functioning, how the ecosystem is functioning, you know, the functioning of the ecosystem, then the ecosystem services and the balance in the ecosystem, everybody should understand, and people should not go against the balance of nature. And if we just, if we can understand the balance in nature, and if we do our activities, perform our activities, without disturbing the natural system, then the disaster or maybe you see hazards, the intensity of all these will decline. And most of the problems now we are facing, including this different kind of diseases caused by bacteria and virus, then you will find it is because of environmental degradation. Throughout the world, it is agreed that more is the degree of degradation of nature, environment, the more problem we shall have to face. Many of the problems, no doubt, associated with our, food production, reproduction system, and in our health system also, healthcare system also, we find a lot of problems actually basically caused by degradation of nature. And we should be very, very careful. And I hope this seminar will be participated by a large number of participants, not only from geography, but also other disciplines. Nowadays, knowledge is, you can't say that knowledge should remain confined to geography. Oh. Geographical knowledge is basic, no doubt, but then we must extend our geographical knowledge to other areas, other disciplines only then, because problem is not 100% geographical. Problem is multidisciplinary, or problem is interdisciplinary. So therefore, in order to understand.
Sound to aha nai.
There may be problem in Bhagavati sir's connectivity. Sorry for that. There may be problem in Bhagavati sir's connectivity.
Yes, I cannot find Bhagavati sir here in the screen.
Yes. Sorry for the inconvenience. Maybe from Bhagavati sir connectivity may be lost going on. Therefore, sorry for that. Other people are we are getting our voice.
Hello.
Hello.
Yes, it's
continue. Yeah. Yeah, boys.
Sorry for that. If you again will get, if you will get the connectivity with Bhagavati sir, we'll deliver the next part of his speech. Now I'd like to request our co-convener, Mr. Simanta Bora sir, to deliver his vote of thanks. Sir, please.
Yes, Simanta Bora sir, please unmute yourself. Yes.
Am I audible?
Yes.
Yeah, audible and share your video. Yeah, you are audible and but share videos. Your video.
Yes.
Yeah. Am I audible?
Yes.
Yes. Yeah.
Very, very good morning, everybody. Honorable distinguished dignitaries and honorable advisors of the national webinar organized by Department of Geography, Borhola College, in collaboration with College Development Council of Dibrugarh University, IQAC of Borhola College, Geography Department of Moriani College, and Chinamura College. I, on behalf of Geography Department of Borhola College, would like to extend our vote of thanks to all of you. Firstly, we would like to offer our thanks to Honorable Principal of Borhola College, Dr. Biren Dutta sir, for giving permission to organize the national webinar and also his valuable speech. Secondly, we would like to extend our heartily thanks to the respected inaugural speaker, director of the College Development Council, Dibrugarh University, Dr. Rupam Shaikia sir, for giving his valuable time and enthusiastic inaugural speech. Thirdly, we would like to render our sincere thanks to the honorable keynote speaker, professor of Geography Department of Guwahati University, renowned writer, prominent geographer, Professor Avani Kumar Bhagavati sir, for providing his precious time and magnificent and resourceful keynote speech. Lastly, we would like to offer our sincere thanks to all the distinguished resource persons for giving their consent as a resource person. We also offer our thanks to all the participants. And thanks to all the members of the organizing team, our colleagues, especially technical teams of the webinar, for their kind assistance. Once again, we are very, very grateful to you all. Thank you very much. Now ended this inaugural session, and next technical session will start without break. I over to Mr. Debojit Duora, moderator of the technical session, to continue the session. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Simanta Dora. Hello, Dr. Meenakshi ma'am. Hello.
Yes, you are audible.
Okay, we can proceed to the first technical session, ma'am.
Okay. Okay.
Good morning, everyone. After a very wonderful inaugural session, we are here in the first technical session of the national webinar entitled Environmental Degradation and Disasters in India. The sub-theme for this particular session is population growth and its impact on environment, human interference with the environment and its changing nature. As it is a civil session, we have 9 numbers of selected papers for presentation. I shall call out the names of the paper presenter one by one and request them to unmute themselves before their presentation only. If they wish, they can even share their screens also during the presentation. Because it is enabled from the host side with the prior setting. Okay. Before going to the presentation, I want to introduce here our research person, Dr. Meenakshi Phookan Hazarika, ma'am, associate professor in the Department of Geography, JB College, Jorhat. Her area of research interests are medical geography, gender studies, and issues related to poverty. She is an eminent educationist, an organizer, and an independent researcher in her area of interest. Her research articles have been published in various leading academic journals of national and international repute. We are really grateful to you, ma'am, and we feel deeply honored by your presence here in this virtual platform. Now over to you, ma'am, Dr. Meenakshi Phookan, ma'am.
Thank you, Mr. Debojit Dwara, Organizing Secretary. So a warm good morning to everyone present. Principal Dr. Biren Dutta Borhula College and organizers from the Department of Geography, Borhula College, and in collaboration with CDC College Development Council, Dr. Rupam Saikya, Professor Bhagavati, A.C. Bhagavati, Dr. Bimal Bora, Professor Mipun and Nayan Chetri, sir, and faculties and resource persons from different parts of India, I would like to welcome you all to this technical session. Since we have 9 papers, I think we can allot 7 minutes each for presentation and 3 minutes for interaction. Is that okay, Mr. Rana Bora?
Yeah. Okay, we can continue with that.
Okay, so we will allot 7 minutes for presentation to each participant and
five
3
to,
minutes.
Yes, ma'am, 5 to 7 minutes for presentation.
Okay. So first of all, let me thank the organizers for selecting me to be a resource person in this wonderful seminar, national seminar. And I really feel good in this, amidst this lockdown, that we have such a wonderful national seminar with more than 1,000 participants. That is incredible. And I believe it will be a wonderful webinar, where we will have fruitful outcome on this topic of environmental degradation and disasters. So may I request our moderator, Mr. Debojit Dwara, to call out the names and...
Okay. We have our paper presenter here, Pronita Hatikakoti. Please unmute yourself, Pronita Hatikakoti. Pronita Hatikakoti, please unmute yourself.
Is she present?
I don't think so. Please raise your hand. Please, the paper presenter for the first technical session, please raise your hand so that I can locate you. We have already unmuted. We have already charged you in our screen and unmuted. You can unmute yourself from your side. So then, Sanmuhita, can you hear me?
I think Sanmuhita is here.
Sanmuhita is here. You can unmute yourself. Or, yeah, yes, she is there in the screen. I request Sanmohita to continue. It is a joint paper by Sanmohita Borkhakoti and our known Dr. Junali Soikia Baido. I request Sanmohita to present her paper.
Hello everyone, my name is Sanmohita Borgakoti and I'll be presenting a paper titled Is Population Growth a Malediction to Environment and Humanity? And also this is my very first paper, so please excuse me if there's any mistakes or anything like that. So let me begin with, from the very inception, be it Adam or Eve or apes and chimpanzees, we have shared a multi-faced relationship with nature. Population growth is actually a very natural process, and humans have, since time immemorial, humans have been dependent on the nature, and humans have been extracting resources from the different spheres of nature, resources that has been sustaining 500 million people in 1650, has now started to sustain 7.7 billion people in the 2020 time. There's a huge pressure on resources, and it is very much important that we analyze the impact of this population on the environment. The objective of this study is to understand how the ever-growing population impacts the environment. We realize the pressure on natural resources due to the increase in population, to understand how population increase contributes to environmental degradation and disaster, to seek some practical remedies to save our environment for sustenance of life. Now, the database for this study is basically secondary data collected from various sources, and this is basically an analytical study which is divided into three parts. Now, the study area that I have selected for this paper is the Republic of India, which is the second most populous and the seventh largest country in the world. Now, this is a map of India with all its political boundaries. Now, we move on to the analysis. So, the very first topic that we are going to analyze is the level of development in India in relation to its population growth and impact on environment. So, the first indicator is population of India. Now, as per UN's latest data, India's population stands at 137 crores, which was 121 crores in according to the census of 2011. And that means over a period of 9 years, the population exploded rapidly. And it is also projected that close to the late 30s, around 2027, India will surpass China as the most populous country in the world. This slide actually shows the decadal growth of population in India from 1901 to 2021. The 2021 data is a projected data from the UN. The second indicator that we are moving on to is population density. Now, higher the population density, higher is the resource depletion and pollution. Now, this is a pie diagram that shows the population density of different major cities in India, and we can see that Northeast Delhi has the highest population density. Now we move on to the third indicator, which is pressure on resources. As I said, higher population density means higher pressure on resources. Now, demographic growth, industrialization is exerting a huge pressure on the natural spectra, right? Forests are declining, agriculture land is degrading and declining, and it is also very shocking to learn that only 10%, a very small number of people, is responsible for 50% of carbon emissions in the world, 50% of carbon emissions from developed countries only. Now, marine life is also dying, right? And these are some pictures. This is an award-winning picture from Nat Geographic, which shows a turtle that is entangled in nylon or plastic ropes, which is actually dumped by us into the ocean. Now, these are some other pictures. Now, one of the very basic things that I learned in my economics major class was human wants are unlimited, but the resources to satisfy these wants are limited. Now, to cater to these whims and fancies of the population, new technologies are being sought out every day. As population keeps on booming, basic necessary resources demand spike up and new technologies were implemented. But amidst this, we are forgetting to ask one of the very important questions, that are these high technologies eco-friendly? Which brings us to our next indicators, that is disasters. Now, the answer to this is very conflicting actually, but 6 months into 2020 and not a single month has passed without a serious disaster taking place, right? Let's just say Uttarakhand forest fire, cyclone Amphan, cyclone Nisarga, and then locust swarms, etc. And the prevalent ones that have been going on since a long period of time, like loss of green cover and agriculture land due to higher demand in residential area, pollution of our rivers like Ganga, Yamuna, landslides, earthquakes, etc. Now, there is a new category of disasters which our keynote speaker actually addressed very well. It is called human-induced natural disasters. The list can begin with untimed floods, landslides, sea level rising, earthquakes, etc. Now, the disasters like the Bagjam gas tragedy or even the Vishakhapatnam gas leak, Gujarat chemical plant explosion, these are human-induced and their effects will be remaining in the nature for a very, very, very long time. Now we move on to the second part of our study, which is factors needing immediate attention responsible for population growth, which results in environment degradation. Now the very first indicator that we are going to see is birth rates and death rates. We need to analyze birth rates and death rates in order to keep population growth in check. The demographic transition theory helps us understand the trend of population growth and increase and declines in birth rate. Now, it is also important to note that developing or underdeveloped countries have booming population, right? But however, developed countries are the ones that have a higher share for environmental degradation. It is because the so-called supposed superpowers like the United States of America, France, China, Russia, UK, Germany, these superpowers are responsible for the historic emissions of a whopping 79% carbon that contributes to climate change. Now we move on to the second indicator, which is poverty. Now people living in poverty are always directly dependent on nature. This poverty with lack of education surmounts to the population explosion, as there is a very deep-rooted notion among those poverty-stricken people that more children will be equal to more work, which will be a higher income for the family. Now, this is a very false notion, actually. Now, these are some pictures from India showing people who are living in poverty. Now, we move on to seeking probable solutions to mitigate the cons of population growth and environment. Now, with the basic ones like family planning, afforestation, switching off fans and lights, etc., we know all of that, right? But one of the most important things that we need to do right now is lifestyle modification, okay? We need to let go of the ego of materialism and live with just what is necessary for us. And every single individual should do their own part, because there is a saying that says, "Bund bund sehi to sagar banta hai." Now, the conclusions that I reached during my period of studies is as follows. Earth has plenty for everyone's need, but not for everyone's greed. And these are not my words. It is the words of our father of nation, Mahatma Gandhi. Now, you know, there are 7.7 billion people in the world, right? That means 7.7 billion brains. That is 7.7 billion human resources. So if that 7.7 billion brains are put to good use, we together can thrive, animals, natures, human alike. So I would like to say that population growth cannot always be a curse to environment and humanity. As Mahapurush Srimanta Shankardev said, Jato jiva jangama kita kata aganaga jagateri kaya. The earth belongs to everyone. And if one species tries to assert its dominance, the very homeostatic mechanism of the earth gets disrupted and we end up in serious situations. Let's just say COVID-19 is one of those situations. Now, whoever said that a single person cannot bring a change, these two pictures will prove you very wrong. On your left, we have Mr. Jadav Pai, who is known as the forest man of India. And this man alone planted a whole forest, which we now know as Molai Forest. And this is Greta Thunberg, a 17-year-old Swedish girl who stood up alone fighting for climate crisis. So if they can do it, so can we. The only survival mantra we need to keep in our minds is love. Love for nature, love for humanity, and love for family. And as our keynote speaker said, that the problem is global, right? The problem of environmental degradation, climate change, sea level rising, it's global. But the solution must begin locally. We must do our very best to do it, to tackle environmental degradation, to stop climate change, etc. Now, these are the references that I use for my studies. And with this, I come to the end of my presentation. So thank you very much.
Very good presentation by Sunmohita. Now the paper is open for discussion, question answers, if anyone wants to interact.
Anyone wants to interact, please raise your hand. You can raise your hand so that I can unmute from our side. So nobody is there. Nobody is there. Yeah, we have in the queue, Dr. Mutusi Bagsi, ma'am. It's a joint paper with Dr. Aditya Kumar Chatterjee. So I request Motusi Bakshi ma'am to present her paper. And other paper presenters for this session are requested to raise your hand so that I can look at you to unmute.
Good morning. Good afternoon, everyone. I hope you can hear me.
Yes,
ma'am. Good
afternoon. I am Aditya.
I am Dr. Motusi Bakshi, and so we will be jointly presenting a paper on population vulnerability to COVID. And just a moment. I hope you can see the screen. That's
Yes,
it is visible, madam.
So, COVID-19 needs no introduction to us, as we are aware of its menace that is going on, and it is actually, you can term it, it is a sort of biological disaster, and its enormity in India has led the government of India to declare it as a notified disaster. And until just after, I think in the month of May, Assam witnessed a sudden spurt of COVID-19 cases in Assam, and which reached to Dibrugarh recently after the return of the migrants. So we will be talking about the population vulnerability to this, actually, to this disaster, and the who are the population to be actually likely to be more affected by this biological disaster. So this is the status of COVID-19 at a glance, which was actually updated, I think, on yesterday. So the world, it stands to almost 78 lakhs people affected by this COVID-19, and India 3.5 lakhs, Assam 4,158. I think by now it has increased, and Dibrugarh it is 112. So, though the case fatality rate is low, but still, this is very much important insofar as the contagious nature of the virus is আৰু ইয়াৰ লগতে কি হৈছে ইয়াৰ ভেকচিনেশ্যন যিহেতু নাই এজ দ্য ভেকচিনেশ্যন ইজ ইয়েট টু কাম আপ চ' ইট ইজ একচুৱেলি আ ডিফিকাল্ট টু কণ্টেইন এণ্ড কণ্ট্ৰল দিছ ভাইৰাছ এলং উইথ ইট ডেম'গ্ৰাফিক ফেক্টৰ্ছ লাইক এজ ষ্ট্ৰাকচাৰ বিহেভিয়াৰ লাইফ ষ্টাইলছ এণ্ড মোবিলিটি হেজ গ্ৰেট ইম্পেক্ট আপন দ্য ছাচেটেবিলিটি টুৱাৰ্ডছ দিছ ডিজিজ. So in Assam, we see that the community transmission has already begun, and which was actually not there in Dibrugarh district, and it has started like yesterday. Lots of reports have come up that some people, they have already started the community transmission. So now we'll just go to the objectives. Now, in our study, actually, we want to say that pathogens and vectors, they are non-selective. They attack human beings without actually seeing whether what to which actually status they belong to. But now, just I'll go through it. Pathogens and vectors attack human beings without discrimination. Human beings, are resistant to this. Human beings' resistance to these diseases depend upon their physiological and sociocultural characteristics. The sociocultural characteristics like racial makeup, behavior, lifestyles, food habit, etc., not only influences the occurrence and prevalence of these diseases, but also molds our perception towards the diseases. That is, the risk of exposure to these diseases, to these pathogens, vectors, actually depend upon our awareness level, our knowledge. So now, in our study, actually, we have selected the tea garden workers or who are represented by, the majority is represented by tea tribes. Why did we select them? Because it is found from our study, and especially from my study, I have found that their innate low literacy level, their lifestyle, their behavior has made them susceptible and vulnerable to certain diseases. So it is more likely that in spite of public health system and policy measures measures undertaken due to this COVID-19 outbreak and spread, it is very vital that the awareness is also needed. So because in any community-based disease control program, awareness level is very much necessary. So an attempt is made in this paper to study the awareness regarding the pandemic among the tea garden workers, because, you know, once they, it is from our study, we have found that there the awareness is there, but at what level the awareness exists. So here, awareness is assessed in terms of knowledge, attitude, and practice regarding the disease, its symptoms, mode of infection, preventive measures, and health management strategies. So we have collected both primary data, and we have also taken certain secondary resources. So 4% of the district total registered tea gardens have been selected as sample survey areas, from where household level data has been collected from 5% of the total households. The knowledge, attitude, and practice about COVID-19 symptoms, process of spreading, source of knowledge, problems faced during the disease and lockdown, preventive measures and health management strategies were analyzed to review that and awareness. Necessary secondary data and information has been collected from government reports, websites, newspapers, etc. So this is our the demographic structure of the respondents. As you can see here, it is very much well depicted. And now we will directly go to the so we find here that 60% of the women respondents have never been enrolled to school, and 41% of the male respondents have never been enrolled to the school. And you can see from this graph that the primary level of education is there, and males represent the middle level of education, and some males have gone to the higher secondary level as well. So these are just the graphs. And now we'll come to the major findings, because there is paucity of time. Knowledge. An overwhelming majority of the respondents have heard about the pandemic, but they claim that they could recognize their symptoms. 91% could recognize the symptoms, and only 10% could actually identify the most common symptom, that is fever. And dry cough was only recognized by 7% as symptom. Although 94% of the respondents knew that it is a highly contagious disease, but a very insignificant proportion, that 2%, could identify that physical proximity or touch as the threat to the spread of this disease. It is pertinent to note that the respondents did not list cough as the most common process of spreading. Insofar as the source of knowledge is concerned, it is found that TV is has been listed by the majority, as they have come to know about COVID-19 from TV and apart from their mobile phones. Insofar as attitude is concerned, it is found that 84% of the respondents considered COVID-19 as a problem, and 77% felt that the lockdown has created certain inconvenience, especially when the members of the family who are also employed as temporary workers or in some other jobs outside the tea gardens had lost their source of income due to the lockdown. The workers opine that such lockdowns proved detrimental to their economic condition, and this is an indication of the indifferent attitude towards the pandemic threat. That is, it is likely that these people who are actually not employed within the tea gardens, they would move out of the tea gardens to search for livelihood in the neighborhood. For earning money, and they may be at risk of exposure to this disease. insofar as practice is concerned, it is quite encouraging to find that the tea garden workers responding positively to the protocols laid down by the district administration, like wearing masks, washing hands with soap frequently as preventive measures. Though a good number, 92% of the respondents knew about social distancing, but they are still ignorant regarding the real significance and have a propensity to gather in a crowd. So we see that in our the experience of India, in spite of social distancing or all the talk about this social distancing, we are still ignoring that which has led to the spread of this disease like wildfire. So when it comes to the tea garden workers, are they likely to practice social distancing if they are outside? Most of the tea garden workers adhere to the timings of movement, working protocols imposed by the management and the government. Now, at the same time, it is quite disheartening to note that the Government of India's digital initiative, Arogya Setu, meant to generate awareness about COVID-19 and connect essential pandemic-related health services to the people of India, is yet to make inroads into the workers' knowledge. That is, they are still ignorant about Arogya Setu. This points out the fact that preventive measures for public health safety is yet to be realized in reality. Now, coming to the conclusion, we see that the Government of India, along with the respective governments, state governments, as well as in the tea gardens, especially the management, are leaving no stones unturned to curb the containment and control of the spread of COVID. Though a good number of centers have been developed in Assam to screen the migrants and quarantine the infected cases, community transmission is gaining ground. And this is in case of Dibrugarh district too. So studies have pointed out that illiteracy, personal hygiene, nutritional status, habit of regular intake of liquor, lackadaisical treatment seeking behavior, etc. of the tea garden workers make them more susceptible to the diseases. So they will be more likely to be exposed to this disease by their ignorance. Thus, it is assumed that in case there is a spillover of COVID-19 infection among the tea garden workers, it will prove to be an alarming threat to the other population groups as well. This study points out the fact that there is a gap in the awareness level in theory and practice. That is what we wanted to highlight, that they knew that, well, we don't have to do that. But when we actually asked through our schedule come questionnaire and by interview that what are you doing, how do you do this, we came to the conclusion that there is a gap. They know well, but they are not practicing. Therefore, a serious effort must be made to bridge this gap in order to control and mitigate the problem of COVID. So we have come to the conclusion, due to the paucity of time, I practically ran through the presentation. Questions are welcome.
Thank you. Thank you for your wonderful presentation. Your presentation in your second slide, I think you had shown Dibrugarh, the cases are higher than all Assam, isn't it? Fatality
is, till yesterday it was 1.
86, 89%, and Assam is just 0.24%.
Because though only one has reported, but when we take the case fatality in respect to Dibrugarh, the cases, so it comes to high.
It's a good presentation. You have done primary survey also. But as far as our position now, I don't think tea gardens are in a very bad position. None of them are affected till now.
None of them are affected, but it is that is what we wanted to highlight, that you see tea garden workers, now we are only talking due to the paucity of time. We could only take the data from, we could conduct the sample survey only in the tea garden areas, tea estates. Well,
that's
within
okay,
the tea
because
estate.
That is okay.
Outside the tea estates, also there are tea garden workers who are more likely to be affected.
Yes, maybe they are practice habits or whatever, they are illiterate, no doubt, but then their habits, I think, and the management, from the management side, they're taking efforts.
Anyway,
good presentation. So now it's open for discussion.
Thank you.
Rituparna Biswas,
please unmute yourself. Rituporno Biswas, I can locate you. You are raising your hand. Rituporno Biswas for question answer session. You are raising your hand. You can unmute yourself. Okay, then we have another paper presenter, Dr. Satak C.
Before that, can I just ask whether Sanmohita is there? Because I thought I would like to give her give my comments on her paper. Sanmohita, yes, you are there. You have made a very good presentation since it's your first presentation, and you are actually the coming up generation. So you have to create the difference, like Greta Thunberg. So you have to create a difference, and I would advise you to suggest. I would suggest you to go for intensive study of a smaller area, okay, instead of taking all India as a whole. And your paper was population growth, a malediction to environment. So you have to show you have to give statistics on what is the impact on resources and the development process, how is it impacting? So you have to give more statistics on those aspects, okay? But otherwise you've made a very nice presentation and all the best. We hope to see you again. Okay, thank you. So the next paper presenter. Pronita is mute, I think. Can you hear? Listen to her. I cannot. Is Pronita audible to others? Pronita, I cannot hear her. Anyway, yes, now we can hear you. Pronita, you can start.
Good morning to everyone. Today I am going to present my seminar paper on the topic population growth and its impact on deforestation in India. Deforestation is the clearing, destroying. Destroying or otherwise removal of trees through deliberate, natural or accidental means. India's population exceeded 1.2 billion in 2011, making it the second most populous country in the world. To satisfy the needs of this growing, more and more forest is destructed every year. The objective of my seminar paper is to discuss about the impact of population growth on deforestation in India and to focus on mitigation measures in India. The methodology of my seminar paper is based on secondary data, which is collected from different books, journals, articles, newspapers, internet, etc. The main causes of deforestation are agriculture. To feed the growing needs of people, for land is converted into agricultural land. As agriculture helps to feed the world's population, it is responsible for deforestation globally. In India, agriculture contributes 45% of the national income, and 70% of Indians are directly dependent upon it. Shifting cultivation, which is also called as slash and burn agriculture, is the destruction of large areas of forest. This is the map of decadal growth of India from 2001 to 2011. This is the top 10 Indian states by population. We can see that Uttar Pradesh has the highest percentage in population. Another causes for deforestation is commercial logging. Forests are being destroyed at an accelerating rate for commercial logging. If commercial logging managed improperly, it removes habitat for birds and other wildlife that use trees for cover. Next, major amount of forest lands are cut in order to promote industrialization in India. India has lost large forests to 23,716 industrial projects in just some years. Mining leaves vast forest lands, such as forest lands that perform various activities. Mining not only related to the cause and effects of deforestation, but also related to causing pollution. Fuel load. Much fuel load is now largely obtained from the sources outside forests, such as scrub, bush, fallow, dead wood, etc., for meeting the energy needs of growing population in India. This is the green cover of India. We see that very dense forest is very low in India, and the non-forest area is growing largely. This is the negative and positive change of forest cover in India. Consequences of deforestation. As we know that deforestation contributes to global warming, cutting down trees release greenhouse gases, including carbon dioxide, into the atmosphere and enhancing global warming. Soil erosion. Deforestation leads to soil erosion. When trees are cut down, rain washes down the soil surface, and soil erosion takes place. Loss of biodiversity. Biodiversity loss is also caused by deforestation. In the foothills of eastern Himalaya, the conversion of natural forests to plantations has reduced the elephant habitat by approximately 30%. Water cycle. Now, as a result of deforestation, precious rain is lost from the area, flowing away as river water and causing permanent drying. Deforestation also raises flooding because trees prevent sediment runoff. Due to deforestation, there is reduction in the infiltration of water into the ground, which causes floods. Deforestation in northern parts of Indian Himalayan regions resulted in floods and landslides. Drought. Large-scale deforestation could cause drought in India. As the forest is cleared, the rain is decreased at a faster rate, leading to longer drought. Mitigation measures to reduce deforestation. Afforestation. Afforestation helps to check the overall use of plants by providing an alternative source. First, afforestation program will not only increase the forest cover, but also help in making up ecological balance. Biodiversity conservation. Biodiversity of the forest areas of India will be surveyed and documented systematically. The Biological Diversity Act 2002 is an act of the Parliament of India for preservation of biological diversity in India. Management of non-timber forest produce. Non-timber forest produce such as medicinal and aromatic plants, oilseed, fiber, resins, wild edibles, bamboo, etc. provide sustenance to forest-dependent communities by supplementing their food and livelihood security. Such produce should be managed sustainably. Promote agroforestry and farm forestry. Agroforestry and farm forestry have taken deep roots in India, and trees are contributing to the increase in tree cover and also enhancing ecosystem services. Forest certification. A credible certification process can provide premium on their products, which can enhance value of forest product harvested sustainably. This is the map of green cover in India. Here we see that the top five states where forest cover is decreasing and another 5 states where maximum forest cover is increasing. This is the statewide forest type distribution in 2011. Here we see the forest cover and also very dense forest and moderate dense forest and open forest area. Indian government role in forest conservation. Here are some act which helps to conserve the forest of India. Indian Forest Act 1927. It defines the procedures for declaring an area as a reserve forest, a protected forest, or a village forest by the state government. With the amendment in the Act in 2012, it also prohibited the phase clearances in forest and setting fire in the reserve forest. Wildlife Protection Act 1972. This act was enacted basically to protect wild animals, birds, and plants and pollinators connected therewith, ensure the ecological and environment security of the country. Forest Conservation Act 1980, the main purpose of the proposition of this act was to conserve the forest and to look into the matter connected therewith or ancillary or incidental thereto. The Biological Diversity Act 2002, this act is an act of the Parliament of India for preservation of biological diversity in India and provide mechanism for equitable sharing of benefits arising out of use of traditional biological resources and knowledge. The Sidhul tribes and other traditional forest dwellers, Recognition of Forest Rights Act 2006. The act was framed with the purpose to recognize and vest the former rights and occupation in forest and in forest dwelling Sidhul tribes and other traditional forest dwellers who have been residing in such forest for generations but whose rights could not be recorded. Apart from this, the Government of India has also established Forest Survey of India, an organization under the Ministry of Environment, Forest and Climate Change, whose primary work is to gather and evaluate the country's forest through a nationwide survey to measure forest areas. Here we come to the conclusion. Due to pressure of rising human population in India, an unscientific method of forest wealth, deforestation is increasing at an alarming rate. A large areas of forest have been removed for rehabilitation, for industrialization, and for irrigation projects. So the common people of India should be informed of the effect of deforestation through newspaper, radio, television, etc. Sustainable forest management practices, alternatives for shifting cultivation, promotion of plantation outside the forest, and the uses of certified forest products, etc. are some of the measures to curb the rate of deforestation. Thank you.
So, if let's have the discussion on the paper, if there is any, then I'll give my comments.
No, ma'am, I have not seen anyone.
Okay, so Pronita, let me tell you one thing. It's good. It's a good effort that you have tried to present this seminar paper amidst this lockdown. But you know, any research paper has to contribute something new. So in your paper, you have given what is already there, what is already existing. So what you should have done is you should have given, say, whatever findings you have given, in that you should have given examples of India. So this is the effect of soil erosion and so-and-so area. This is the effect of global warming. What is the temperature increase in the cities? You should have mentioned all these aspects. And regarding the acts, you know, everyone knows about the acts. What are the preventive measures? So your preventive measure should have come out from your paper. Why is soil erosion occurring in so-and-so area? Why is global warming, the cities are having temperature differences than the rural areas? So what steps should be taken? Okay, so you should incorporate all this into your paper, and your seminar paper, research paper has to give a new result. It has to contribute something new. Okay.
Okay, ma'am. Thank you.
Next, I request Dr. Sataksi from B.R. Ambedkar Bihar University to present her paper. Please unmute yourself.
Satakshi is replying here in the chat that she is not audible. She cannot hear. She has just written in the chat box. Now, can you hear Satakshi? She says yes. She can't hear the audio. Mr. Yeah. Devjit Borwa, she has written to me, Satakshi, that she cannot hear the audio. I have given that message to the Department of Geography, Borhola College.
Yes, yes, ma'am. I am trying to unmute her. Okay. Yes, Dr. Satakshi, if you are hearing me, then please unmute yourself. We have already activated the unmute button from our side. Please unmute. Yes, you are unmuted. You can continue.
If she's having a problem, we
okay,
can
yeah.
to someone.
Yeah,
okay.
I request Dr. Gangane Jiban Sudam Rao, please raise your hand so that I can look at you. All the paper presenters assigned for this first session, I request you all to raise your hand so that I can look at you. We have previously unmuted you, but because of some technical issues, you are muted again. We are trying from our side to unmute you. Please raise your hand.
Gangane, Gangane Jeevan Sudam Rao.
Yeah.
From Vivekananda Mahavidyalaya.
Then Mrs. Jusna Bora from Dr. Nobin Borle College, I request you to raise your hand so then I can unmute you.
Jusna Bora, are you there?
Yeah.
Okay, so I think Jusna can start.
Yeah, she can start.
If you are there, you can start. Can you see her? I cannot see her.
Yeah, I'm trying to locate her. She's not there. Then I, Mr. Apurva Kumar Gogoi from Sinamora College.
Apurva Kumar Gogoi.
The participants are joining their personal ID. So,
put their names.
We are not able to locate you.
See them
through
yes.
your name. Even I have.
Is Seema Saikia from Pragjyotika Junior College, Titabor there? She can start. Seema Saikia.
Seema Saikia, if you are. Here in the virtual platform, please raise your hand.
Satakshi, now she's saying I'm here.
Yes, you can start. Dr. Satakshi, yes, you can start.
that she is on mute.
Okay. Yes.
She can. You can start now, Satakshi.
Hello, ma'am. Hello, ma'am. Can
hello.
You
hear me? Yes, yes, ma'am.
Yeah, I'm not able to get the audio.
We can hear you now.
That's very logged out. And...
Okay.
Okay, ma'am. Thank you. Ma'am.
Start.
Can you see my slides, ma'am?
No, you have to share your screen, I think. On the bottom of your window, just see. Can you see the share screen?
Yes, there is a connectivity issue from her side only. So I request Krishnanu Borua, if you are here in the virtual platform, please raise your hand. Sima Swikya. So, ma'am, because of nobody is there because of time constraint, we have to continue the session. I request Dr. Meenakshi ma'am to deliver her speech, considering all the pros and the cons of the papers participated till now.
Okay. So we are winding up this session?
Yeah.
Okay, okay. So it was very nice to actually to see at least three presenters who could give their presentation, who could deliver their presentation amidst this lockdown. And it's good to see them active, although we would have loved to hear from the other six participants, but because of connectivity problem, they are trying, but they have not been able to log in or connect. So we had three papers, Population Growth, A Malediction to Environment and Humanity by Sonmohita, then the Vulnerability of T-Tribes Population, I think, by Dr. Let me see the paper. Population Vulnerability to COVID-19 by Dr. Motusi Bagchi, which was a very nice paper because she had collected primary data. It's a joint paper with Dr. Aditya Kumar Chatterjee. And she has tried to find out the population vulnerability of the tea tribes people. And she has found that their illiteracy and ignorance might become a problem when there is a spread of or increase of cases of coronavirus in our region. And the last paper was by Pronita. So population, her paper was on impact of population growth on deforestation in India, which needs to add a few more figures and facts because she has to show the impact of deforestation in India, citing examples and case studies if as applicable. So I think these three were the papers presented, and I would like to thank the organizers for inviting me here as a resource person. I'm very glad to be here. I'm among so many faculties and researchers, and it is like attending a session in our college. It's like one of those sessions. So thank you once again for everything. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, ma'am. We conclude here the first technical session, and I request Barnali Kaur, over to you for the next technical session, that is technical session 2. I request Barnali Kaur. Can you hear me, Barnali? Barnali Kaur, can you hear me?
Yes, yes.
Yeah. Okay, over to you, ma'am.
Okay. Thank you. Thank you, Devoji. Welcome, everyone. Thank you for joining us in today's webinar. I am Barnali Kaur, librarian, Borgla College. Respected principal, our most valued resource person, participants, ladies and gentlemen, it's my privilege to have been asked to moderate this occasion. The webinar is organized by Department of Geography, Borgla College, in collaboration with College Development Council, Dibrugarh University, IQAC, Borgla College, and Department of Geography, Moriyoni College, and Sinamra College, Jorhat, Assam. The webinar is intended to be multidisciplinary and multilingual national level webinar on environmental degradation and disaster in India. The sub-theme of this session is socio-political issues related with environment and disaster effects on economy and environment. We are very fortunate to have Dr. Bhupendra Nath Goswami as a research person for this session. Dr. Goswami is working as an associate professor, Department of Geography, Moriyoni College, Jorhat. He is a prominent scholar, renowned writer, published many books, articles in different national and international journals. A live version of this webinar is available on the YouTube live also. Today we have 9 papers. Just a little housekeeping before we get started. Due to the time constraints, 5 minutes are allotted for presenting. 5 to 7 minutes are allotted for presenting every paper. If you have any questions during the presentation, please type them into the question box in your Zoom panel or raise your hand. I will bring them up during the presentation, and I will also have time for questions at the end. Now, without further, we are moving on to the presenter. So I would like to hand over to the mic to our resource person. Sir, please. Goswami sir?
Yes, I'm here myself.
Sir, please continue.
Okay, I am here. I'm waiting for you.
Okay.
Hello.
Yes, sir.
Do you listen me? Listen to me?
Yeah. You are audible. Yeah.
অডিঅটো এনেবল কৰি থৈ দিয়া আছে
Usami sir, you are audible and visible also, sir.
Oh, have you not seen me?
Sir, you are audible. Your voice is clear, sir.
Okay, then continue.
Yeah, okay, sir.
Hello.
Hello.
Yes.
Hello.
Yes, sir. Please continue.
Okay, then. So I am thankful to all of you, as I was invited as a research person for this technical session. The theme, I think it was socio-political issues related with environment and disaster and post-disaster effects on economy and environment. So certainly the topic, the theme of this particular session is a quite meaningful and also very important one for this particular time, critical time. So I request all the participants to continue their presentation.
Barnali ma'am, please proceed.
Okay. Now I would like to invite our first presenter, Akashi Borua. Akashi Borua. Akashi Borua, please raise your hand. Akashi Borua, are you present here? Your name is not visible. Akashi Borua, please, if you are present here, then please raise your hand. Your name is not visible here. Akashi Borua, are you present? I think she is not present here, so I would like to invite next presenter, Bhagyashree Bora. Bhagyashree Bora, Your name is also not visible here. Are you present here, Bhagyashri? I think he also not present here. Kirtiras, now I would like to invite Kirtiras, Assistant Professor Political Science, School of Law, Alliance University, Bengaluru, Karnataka. Kirtiras, sir, are you present? I think he is also not present. Now I would like to invite Priyanka Barua, Assistant Professor, Department of English, Don Bosco College, and Mridul Setia, Assistant Professor, Department of Chemistry, Debras Roy College.
Maybe not online.
Mridul Setia sir, please present your paper. Mridul Setia sir. Mridul Setia sir. Mridul Setia sir, are you?
So let's proceed to next one. He may be not on the line, I think so.
Okay, sir. Now I would like to invite Madhurima Besparua, MSc student, Department of Seed Science and Technology, Assam Agricultural University, Jorhat. Thank you.
Good afternoon. Ma'am, can I?
You are audible.
Ma'am, can you hear me? Hello, ma'am. Can you hear
me? Yes. You are audible. You can start your presentation.
Good afternoon, resource persons. Today I'm going to present my online on the topic Flood, a Natural Disaster and its Impact on Indian Food Production. So as we all know that agriculture provides livelihood to almost 3/4 population of India, and 62% of crop area of India is dependent on the monsoon rainfall. And contribution of the footprint production or agriculture sector to the gross domestic product is 17%. And as we all know that flood is a major disaster, so it has an adverse effect on the footprint production. And flood is actually a condition that occurs when water overflows the natural or artificial of a stream of other body of water. And it has also a large impact on the food security, food production, and encouragement to out-migrate. So this is basically the food map India. Here we can see that the millets, it is cultivated basically in the plateau region of India, and the wheat, it is also cultivated in the plateau region, basically in Uttarakhand, Bihar, Karnataka especially. And rice, as you all know that it is mainly cultivated in the northeastern part of India and also in some patches of Western Ghats. So this is the distribution of India. So we can see that Assam, UP, Bihar, and Orissa are some of the major areas which are severely prone to floods. And around 12% of land in India is prone to floods. And government of India said that it is hopeful of achieving the record of food grain production target of 291.1 million tons for 2019-20 crop year, as floods in some parts are expected to hurt crops in June-July season. So it is a pie chart showing the flood-prone areas of India. Here we can see that in UP, it is mainly affected by the flood. 21.9% of the agricultural land is affected by flood. And in Assam, its share is 9.4%. And according to Ministry of Water Resources, between 1953 and 2017, on an average, floods that damaged the crop worth ₹1,679 crore per year. And the source is from Wikipedia. And the main objectives of my seminar is to examine the impact of flood on Indian food grain production and to focus on the problems faced by the farmers and the various strategies or various policies to achieve the optimum yield in the grain production. Now, my paper is based on two methodologies. So first, flood years has been identified from the India monsoon rainfall data. And this paper is based on the secondary data and collected from various journals, Google and Wikipedia. So let's come to the uncertainties and the various erosion. When there is heavy downpour of water that is already degraded, it increases possibilities of flash flood. Next is the biodiversity depletion and agricultural land degradation. And these two pictures, it shows the flood affected areas of Orissa and West Bengal especially, and which leads to flooding. And my paper is based on some results. So during flood years, total food grain production decreased to 24%, and all the flood years have noticed increasing hurry food grain production over the previous years. And it has also led to impact in the rabi food grain production, and almost 37% of flood events have depicted decrease in the rabi food grain production. Now let's see the impact of flood in Indian food grain production. So as we all know that it has a large impact on the economy sector of our country, and the largest losses is in the agricultural sector. And this this has changes in the crop and livestock yield, as well as it has changed, it has also impact on the global sector. And also it leads to the crop failure and leads to food insecurity. And also there is destruction of roads by flooding. There is disruption and communication system. And also flooding was found to reduce the farm income of the farmers. And also it alters the seasonal pattern by causing a rise in the food price as a result of crop failure. And Central Water Commission data says that on an average, annually, flood affects 7.2 million hectares of land in India. These are the losses in food grain production due to monsoon in India. 30,000 million hectares of food grains affected in 12 districts of Uttar Pradesh, and maize crops are affected in the Simachal region of Bihar. And in case of Assam also, the average value of crop loss is more than 75%. This is the map which shows the havoc caused by flood. Here we can see that in Assam, 4,222 hectares in the Gulaghat, Jorhat districts, and a major havoc is caused in the Maharashtra region. Here, 20 people killed and 28,000 families evacuated from this. And despite the negative impacts of flood, we have to also see the positive impacts. So as we know that the land, it depends on the periodic silt deposit, and which leads to addition of nutrients to the soil. And as a result of flooding, there are many advantages also, like filtering and dilution of the pollutants which enter the waterways, or flushing of nutrients in the river system, recharging of the groundwater, and so on. And the widespread flood has also a significant and impact on the long-term economic growth of the affected region. So that the government, they can focus on the degrading part of the country. And so now here are the preventive measures. So as we know that our flood is a natural disaster, it can come in any time, anywhere. So the farmers, they should be equally sensitized and equipped with the skills of adaptation of climate change to improve the large-scale food production. And also the other measures include climate smart agriculture to develop flood resistant crops, then construction of drainage networks, and also the food aid distribution. It is an immediate concern for governmental and non-governmental organization. And also our agriculture secretary Shobhana K. Patnaik said various schemes like Pradhan Mantri Krishi Sinchai Yojana, Pradhan Mantri Fasal Bima Yojana, Soil Health Card, and E-NAM were expected to increase the farm input and farmers' income. So conclusion, so the food grain production is more vulnerable to flood, and therefore flood management should be given special and essential attention for the sustainable food grain production. Rice, as we all know that it is an important staple food grain, and this rice is mostly sensitive among all the agricultural crops to the climate extremes. So it needs better planning to meet the future demand. And for that, we can enhance the irrigation facility, forecasting of climate extremes to minimize the negative impacts of these extremes are required for food security and sustainable development, which is very essential in a developed country like India. So this is all about, and thank you for your patience.
So thank you, Madhuri Mahabhaspura, for your nice paper presentation. I think you need to add some other things also, likewise the sense of cropping season. It was actually essential at this moment, because most of the states bordering Himalaya are suffering from flood damages every year, So therefore, if we sense the cropping season, certainly it will benefit the farmers and also enrich the national economy also. So among all the positive impact, you need to mention about this particular point. Certainly it will be a very good paper. I think you will do more works on this particular aspect because it is a very sensitive issue for the entire country, particularly the states bordering the Himalayan region, because they are continuously, relentlessly suffering from floods every year. So thereby some alternatives is essential to formulate some measures, particularly to enrich our economy, right? Okay, thank you, Madhurima. So next presenter. So now paper is open for discussion. If anybody have queries, you may raise your.
If anybody have queries, then raise your hands, please.
Thank you, Madhurima.
Yes, ma'am. Thank you.
Okay, thanks, Madhurima.
Thank you, sir.
No queries for you for your paper. It's okay. Thanks for once again.
Hello, Madhurima.
Next presenter, Dr. Juma Das, Assistant Professor, Department of Political Science, Gugam College, Hemaji. Next presenter is Dr. Juma Das.
Hello, ma'am.
Yes.
Hello.
Hello.
Am I audible, sir?
Yes.
Hello.
Yeah, you are audible.
Yeah, thank you. Good afternoon, respected chairperson, respected other members, and all the participants. Today, myself, Dr. Juma Das, from Gogamukh College, from the Department of Political Science, is going to just present a paper. Although the time has assured us that 5 to 7 minutes, so I have prepared a very short presentation. I'm going to share my screen. Is it visible, ma'am? Hello?
Yeah.
Hello.
Please continue.
My paper is on socio-political issues related with environment and disasters. So it's a connection I'm going to show between many people says that geographical and environmental issues or disasters may not have any connection with social or political issues, but they have very different and distinct connections with each other. And three specific areas I have chosen. So first of all, that is introduction about the paper. Environment means the surrounding or conditions in which a person, animal or plant lives or operates. And social and political issues have some distinct and very close relationship with environment and disasters. That means that environment have connection with us socially, because we human beings, we are the creator of some problems. Along with that, we are also sufferers. And with this also, we have some connection with the, many people may think that there is no connection between political issues and environment, but there are some definite connections, because it is the political considerations that can determine who is at most of risk, who can intervene, what actions will be taken, and who will benefit from those actions. So there are distinct connections that in the introduction, and that is the theme of the paper. Now, the main objectives of the study to highlight the link between the different socio-political issues related with environment and disasters, then to focus on the different social and political issues which have direct or indirect impacts on climate change. Three issues I have taken already, I said. One is climate change, one is construction of dams, and the other one, soil pollution. So the third objective is to focus on the different social and political issues related with the construction of dams. And the fourth one is to focus on the different social and political issues which are directly...
Excuse me, ma'am. Jumadas, madam.
Yes.
Your PPT is not open. Only not open. Showing the folders. PPT is not open, madam. Please open your PPT.
PPT, please.
It is visible in my computer, sir.
It is not visible here, actually.
Okay, sir, then continue. Okay, madam, then continue.
So let me try once. It is shown that screen sharing has stopped as the shared window is closed.
Again, share it, no problem.
Okay, okay.
You please continue your verbal presentation. If you have some practical problems,
yes, sir.
You may continue your verbal presentation.
Okay, sir. Yeah.
Hello.
Yes, sir.
Yes.
Sir, I have sent you the PPT. Can you display it?
Okay. You can continue with your verbal presentation. No problem. That's okay.
Sir, once you try, please.
Dr. Juma Das, you please continue your verbal presentation.
Okay, sir.
Because time will be running out.
Okay, sir. I'm discussing the objectives actually. So there are four objectives. First one is to highlight the link between the different socio-political issues related with environment and disasters. Then the second one is to focus on the different social and political issues which have direct or indirect impacts on climate change. Then another one is to focus on the different social and political issues related with construction of dams. And the fourth one, the last one, is to focus on the different social and political issues which are directly or indirectly responsible for soil pollution. So for this paper, I'm following four methodologies: historical method, descriptive method, explanatory method, and analytical method. And then the issue related to climate change, I have just given a brief introduction about climate change. What is climate change? Climate change actually is a change in global or regional climate pattern, particularly in a change appropriately, it's means atmospheric release of carbon dioxide, and it is definitely happens for the production and the use of burning of fossil fuels, which is most important reason of climate change. Now there are different reasons and causes responsible for climate change. Suppose human activities are there, industrial activities are there, production of greenhouse gases are most important reason which are coming out from different human and industrial activities. Increasing the amount of water vapor in the air, melting of Arctic sea, then burning of fossil fuels, volcanic eruption, changes in solar energy, and obviously the one of the most important reason, the race of industrialization of the different nations to achieve more and more economic power. So these are some causes responsible for climate change. Now, what are the social issues that are most importantly related with climate change? First social issue is human activity, which is contributing a high amount of impact on climate change by producing greenhouse gases, aerosols in small particles, and obviously cloudiness. And these all are coming from burning of fossil fuels. Then comes about industrial activities with agricultural activities. These are also important social issues which are responsible for climate change, like different use land use pattern, land cover patterns, which are releasing most important greenhouse gases like methane and nitrous oxide. Then use of fertilizers and manure for better production releases high amount of greenhouse gases, obviously. Then comes about one activity which is practiced by human beings, that is deforestation. Deforestation, which is a major source of 80% deforestation is caused for agricultural activities, and which is major source for greenhouse gases. The production of coffee, tea, plum oil, rice, rubber, and other various popular products are responsible for the emission of greenhouse gases. And these all activities are related with, these are all our own human activities with greenhouse gases. Then comes about desertification. Human beings are using plowing, then overgrazing of animals. These are causing high amount of desertification, and which is also responsible for floods, droughts, and somehow they have direct or indirect connection with global warming. Then one of the most important activity related to our society and with the human beings, that is urbanization, which have both push and pull factors. Suppose push factors means rural shifting of rural population to the urban areas, and pull factor, that is the job opportunities and attractiveness of the urban areas, which are also responsible for global warming. Now, about the political issues which are related with climate change. There are actually the vast majority of the national interest of the nation depends on energy production. And energy production have direct connection with global warming. Climate change, now everybody, every nation of this world, they know that climate change is going on and it is harming us directly and indirectly. So every nation realizes that we must concentrate on the different adaptation policies for the controlling of global warming and climate change. But although we realize, but there are some difficulties which are facing by different nations, especially the underdeveloped and developing nations, to adapt the principles properly. Suppose the difficulties are ecological, that are natural constraints, then economic poverty, lack of financial resources, then technological difficulties are there, like insufficient knowledge, unavailability of adequate technologies, and weakness of the state institutions. Besides that, the least developed countries, they are not well equipped with successful adaptation policies autonomously. Means they are not independent to adapt this policy. And most important issue related with climate change is the north-south divide between the which is a very popular principle, that is equal but differentiated responsibilities for both developed and developing underdeveloped nations in the Rio de Janeiro Art Summit. But there is always, we see different difficulties and divide between north south to use this principle of equal but differentiated responsibilities. Then I have come to the next issue that I have chosen, that are dams, construction of dam. What is a dam now? A dam is a barrier that stops or restricts the flow of water or underground streams. Now, dams are caused for different reasons, like irrigation purposes, human consumption, electricity generation, industrial use, aquaculture, navigability, and different purposes. Now, there are definitely some social issues which are related with them. Suppose there are impacts, general and the particular impacts are there, but now socially, dams, construction of dams, how they impact the people. First of all, the first impact, dam construction definitely forces people to leave their homes from nearby areas. We have seen this from long time. Then if natural fisheries are affected, that harms the livelihood of the local people. Farmers of the downstream are impacted. They are also losing their livelihood. Then dams are releasing some heats, which are dangerous for some animals, which kill some shoreline animals. Then it also causes disappearance of birds, forest, wetland, farmland, etc. Then huge risks of flood in the nearby areas. Many old cultural values of the indigenous people may disappear. Old religious monuments may disappear. Then the dam construction of dam may have the issues of migration problem, resettlement problem of the local people. These are some social issues. Now I'm coming to the political issues. Political dams are big part of political controversies from long time. Suppose the issue of rehabilitation and resettlement is related with the government and how they provide this. That is a big matter of controversies and discussions from long time. Then again, relocated people, how they will provide them livelihood, how government will provide them livelihood. Then famous dams are always raised many international, national, and regional movements related to pollution control, flood control, and many cultural and social issues. And one more political issue, we can say that rehabilitation process, which is related with construction of dams for the people who will be dispersed or evacuated from the area, that have rampant corruption issues, scandals, and human rights violations. And then another point is that sometimes opposition parties, pressure groups, non-governmental organizations are also taking these issues for against ruling government or for the benefit of local people, for the area, or for the benefit of all. So these are some political issues which I found related with dams. There are many more maybe, but these are some of the issues which I incorporated in my paper. Then the another part I have taken, that is about soil pollution. Now, what is soil pollution? Soil pollution, all of us, we know, as part of land degradation caused by some toxic chemicals in soil, which deteriorated the condition of soil and which may be create risks to human health and obviously to our ecosystem. Now, causes of soil pollution, agriculture is a massive cause, excessive and improper use of pesticides, then excessive industrial activity, then poor management or insufficient disposal of waste. These are some causes, big causes of soil pollution. Then some social issues which are related with soil pollution. Again, I'm coming to human activities because we human beings are maximum times responsible for soil pollution. As proper disposable of waste materials, we are not doing. Industrial activities are most important reason. Then use of more and more pesticides are main some of the most important sources of soil pollution. Then construction of buildings, deforestation, overgrazing are some of the most important human activities that are responsible for soil pollution. And this soil pollution impact us directly or indirectly because it raises some health risks for both humans and animals. Like water pollution also caused from soil pollution, which is dangerous for our health. Consumption of those water may kill many animals, and even it is health diseases like soil pollution, the contaminated lead, it create tissue damage, irritation, then some difficult diseases, incurable diseases like cancer, neurological problems are also some results of soil pollution. Then if we come to the political issues related with soil pollution, that is, we found that whatever I found that some use of military weapons sanctioned by the government time to time is a real threat to soil pollution. Then licensing of chemical mining industries, which are also major sources of soil pollution. Then excessive use of chemicals, fertilizers, and their wide markets, and the permissions given by government is also are some sources of soil pollution. Dumping of hospital waste by different government hospitals, maybe non-governmental hospitals, are also the sources of soil pollution. Nuclear weapon production, huge amount of nuclear weapon production from different countries of the world, and they are sanctioned by the government, is also the result of soil pollution. Construction of dams also are some sources of soil pollution. So these are some political issues which are related with soil pollution. So as PPT is not disposable, displayable, so I have taken some images, some other slides and charts actually to show about those things, but due to technological problem, please pardon me. Now about the concluding part, summary part, we have come to know from this discussions that social and political issues have distinct connections with environment. Then different human activities are very much responsible for climate changes like land use pattern, deforestation, desertification, urbanization. Then the policy of implementation of the different nations to protect climate change in political matters are also responsible for production of greenhouse gases, which are really changing our climate, and then construction of dams, which raises some real threats for the different societies and nearby areas of the construction sites. Different political controversies are part and parcel related to the construction of dams in different parts of the world. And human activities are really responsible for soil pollution, improper disposable of waste, many other. And obviously, use of military weapons, then licensing of chemical industries, permission of using chemical fertilizers, and different activities are responsible from the side of government. Although government has taken a lot of measures and all for this, but still we cannot stick to other ways, or the implementation process may not be proper in some parts. So these are some issues which are related, social and political issues related with climate change, construction of dams, and soil pollution. Thank you for giving me the opportunity to present this paper. Thank you, organizers, panelists, on the respected members. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Dr. Juma Das.
Thank you, sir.
Indubitably, your paper, the title of the paper is a very sensitive one at yes, this sir. Present time situation.
Yes,
so I think it should have a very sound database.
Yes, sir. Yes.
So your paper still remain as simply descriptive one. So you try to make it database. Number one.
Okay.
Number two, climate change is not only related with all these problems, it is also related with the carbon dioxide. Right?
Yes.
So carbon dioxide is a vital one, particularly in the climate change processes, which was already confirmed by all the scientists world wide. For example,
yes,
during 1750, the amount of carbon dioxide in air was only 280 ppm. In 1980, it becomes 339 ppm. In 2018, it becomes 407 ppm. And in 2008, it is now 417 ppm. So scientists already commented that if the process goes on, then certainly the temperature of the atmosphere will rise by 2 to 3 degrees centigrade by 2025, right? So this way, the carbon dioxide, the most important source of carbon dioxide are the industrial activities, flying motor vehicles. That means almost all the industries or the sources which uses hydrocarbon particularly as well, they're responsible for the increasing amount of carbon dioxide in our atmosphere. So since your topic is related with the climate change, so thereby you need to give some impetus particularly to this point, right? So sir, I hope you will raise the standard of your paper by adding all these important aspects. And then second aspect is the river dam.
Yes, sir, full paper.
Right? So river dam may be one,
yes,
one specific paper, because we are the people of Assam is facing a serious problems from the ongoing construction of the river dam. Right?
Yes,
so already 160 big dams are proposed to be constructed in the parts of Himalayan rivers, this is Arunachal rivers. So if those come in practice or practically, then certainly it will damage the entire scenario, climatic scenario, or the socio-political scenario of the region, right? So I think you will get more and more informations and make your paper database,
yes,
to raise the standard of your paper, okay? Dr. Madhumaras, congratulations for your nice presentation.
Yes, sir.
Now the paper is open for discussion.
Thank you, sir. Thank you.
Now the paper is open for discussion. If anybody has any question, you may raise, please. Is there anybody having questions for this paper?
No, sir.
Then continue, please.
Yeah, proceed on. We can proceed with another paper presenter.
Okay.
Thank you, sir.
Here I saw Mridul Setia, sir. So I want to ask Mridul Setia, do you want to present your paper now? Mridul Setia, sir, please raise your hand. I want to invite Dr. P.B. Asal, Associate Professor and Head of the Department Geography, Azad Mahavidyalaya, Osa Latur, and Mr. Swami B.M., Assistant Professor, Department of Geography, Walsan College, Arts and Sciences, Latur.
Hello.
Please present your
name. Hello.
Yes. Yes.
Hello. Madam.
Yes.
Namaste.
Yes,
oh, madam, already, but madam, I have PPT, no. I'll only reading paper, reading.
Okay.
National seminar, Burla College, and organizers, principals, around Department of Geography, Dibrugarh University, Assam. My paper's name is study of non-formal environmental education in India. Abstract, the environmental scenario of India is a very wide our country's highly diverse climatology, geologically, geographically, and equally, forestically, financially, ethically, language, sociology, and economically. Therefore, environmental education has to be instantly location specific at the first level. Special attention must be paid to school going children and women. Chief goals of environmental education in India must be to improve the quality of environmental, create an awareness among the people on environmental problem and conservation, to create an atmosphere so that people participate in design, making, and develop the capability or to evaluate the development program. Most people recognizing the urgent need for environmental education, but only some have clear ideas but about what need to be done, and very few of either the actual experience or the knowledge about the course that need to be taught. The chief objective of environmental education is that individual and social group should acquire awareness and knowledge, development attitudes, skill, abilities, participant in slowing the real life environmental problem. The perspective should be integrated, interdisciplinary, and holistic eye character. The left planning, the rural, tribal, slum, and urban areas women and students, teachers in school, college, university, as well as planner and design policy maker programs, implement and rural development works need to be educational about the environment. There is need for a new approach educational which go across various subjects at school and higher level non-formal environmental education. It is designed for an age group working in social, economic and cultural development of the community. They form groups of club and arrange exhibitions, public lecture, meeting, environmental campaigns. Objectives: the study of non-formal environmental education in India. Second, find out different type course and program at environmental level. Methodology: the present study of social forest is total based on secondary data that has been collected from the various ecology and sustainable development related articles, magazine, research paper, report, and environmental governmental websites, as well as published a book of environmental subject with the daily newspaper. Introduction: the issue of environmental education has been fully discussed in several nation and international seminars, workshops, and conference. After the deliberation talks in 1971 and United Nations Conference on Human Environmental Environment at Stockholm in 1972, in national seminar organized by the Indian Environmental Society in collaboration with the International Program on Environmental Management at the Indian National Science Academy, New Delhi, 1979, it was given improved Gandhian thought values as part of environmental education. A number of new objective and guiding principles developing environmental education at all level, in both formal and non-formal level, for formulated at the conference UNESCO. Meaning of non-formal environmental education. Non-formal environmental education include awareness and training, which plays significant role in increasing and enhancing people participation activities aimed at conservation, protection, and management of the environmental system of achieving sustainable development. Non-formal environmental education is integral part lifelong learning concept that allow of young people and about at inquiries and mentions the skill, abilities and outlook needed to adapt or consider changing environmental. Non-formal environmental education, the following constitute main content of the education. Adult education. Adults may influence the other member for better ways of life in local language, information text, posters, slides, audio, visuals, etc. may be generated. Rural youth in student youth. They may organization into groups, travel, forested dollars, the program of education can be taken up by involving the community leaders, women and young youth. They are in important contact of our forest with children activities. They can consider, insert through the easy completion difference is group ministry of environmental forest with the help of United until school organized of India organized such activities with on the spot painting, modeling, the posters, designs, concepts are conducted for children by the National Museum and Natural History. Short-term courses are also given in environmental education every year. Eco-developmental camps. The help on rural development involving youth, a set of the guidelines has been prepared by Ministry of Environmental and Forest. The main objective are to create awareness the student, non-student youth about basic ecological principle, identified root cause of ecological problem as related to human activities, to take steps to slow local ecological environmental problems development, spread national integration, non-governmental organizations. There are over 200 NGO, of which the most are involved and in environmental education and awareness other in nature conservation, pollution control, forestry and social forestry, forestization, funnel studies, rural development, wildlife conservation and waste utilization and eco development, population, public representative. India has the environmental forums, MPs and MLAs discusses environmental problem facing the countries. They may build up sound public opinion and citizen public interest. Training senior executives and administrators. Regular courses should be arranged for various institutes importing such training. These are general environmental management, industry specific environmental management, etc. A foundation course, for probationary selected for the IAS, IAFS, SIPS and candidates of their wing armed course need to be supplemented with the foundation course on environmental relevant to their area and work of work research and development program. Such program are supported by Ministry of Environmental and Forest in man and biosphere and basic applied environmental problem. Central of Excellency, Ministry of the Environmental and Forestry established two countries excellence in country. The general knowledge and methodology and training in area to tropical, ecological and environmental educational Ahmedabad. Development of the trained manpower. The must of training program for the trainer, professional, technical, professional and legal expert. The development of the educational material and teaching aids, audio, visual material, of the media, TV, radio, film, newspaper, etc., mobile education, etc., must be designed by competent manpower from such center, e-center of for environmental educational Ahmedabad World Environmental Day. All governments in the states, UTs, academic institute, universities, college, school, and voluntary organized sustainable activities on this day, June 5th. Ministry of Environmental and Forest support this financially. National Environmental Awareness Campaigning, National Environmental Campaigning for 1986. Ministry of Environmental and Forest conduct near NNACS and NIM for November 9th and December 18th. Every year to observe the NIM, each year there is major environmental theme. National Green Crop Program implement by the Ministry Environmental Financial 2011-2002 with the objective of spreading environmental awareness among school children by establishing Eco Club. Forestry educational training expenses. The activities performed by DFOR in Institute of the Ministry Environmental and Forest, like Indira Gandhi National Forest Academy, Dehradun, Directorate for Forest of the Education, Indian Council of Forestry Research and Educational, Indian Plywood Industries Research and Training Institute, Bangalore, in Indian Institute of Forestry Management, Bhopal. Conclusions, non-formal environmental education is problem-oriented and particular program rather the discipline-oriented. It is interdisciplinary in approach and implies the collective effort by the natural and social scientists. Non-formal environmental education aims to provide scientific basics to slow real particular problem, the research management through understanding the environmental problem in the ecosystem context. Finally, it needed to follow system approaches. You find best possible solution under a given set conditions. The help of the types of education bring us together to planner, policy maker, manager, and scientist for the achieving rational design on the issue resource management to utilize diverse learning about the environmental default approaches, teaching and learning about environmental courses to relate environmental sustainable knowledge, problem solving, and value celebrity at very level. Okay, thank you, madam. Hello.
Thanks, Mr. AP Bapurao, for your nice presentation.
Okay, thank you, sir.
I think the preparation of your paper is undoubtedly a holistic one. So it's a demand of time. Formal and non-formal environmental education is necessary at present because the world is going to face a severe crisis from environmental education. So I think your paper is in character, deductive one. But if you convert it into inductive one, then certainly it will give more impetus, particularly. Okay, Mr. Bapura, you try it.
Yes, sir. Thank you, sir.
Thanks for once again. Okay, thank you.
Okay, sir. Thank you, sir.
Okay, thanks. Welcome. So now the paper is open for discussion. Anybody may raise their queries.
Oh,
is there any query? Please raise your hands. So I think no queries at all at present. So let's proceed to the next one.
Okay. So I would like to invite Kavita Manohar, Sri Shankaracharya University of Sanskrit, Kaladi, Kerala.
Hello, ma'am.
Yes, you are audible. Okay. Please continue.
Okay, I have no PPT. I will orally present the paper.
Okay.
Good afternoon, all. I'm Kavita Manohar, doing MPhil Sociology in Sri Shankaracharya University, Kaladi. My topic is Unveiling Noise Pollution from Social Religious Sentiments and Eco-Social Study from Kerala. Before I begin, let me quote a poem by Dr. K.V. Mohan Kumar, winner of Kerala State Sahitya Academy Award. For non-Malayalis, please excuse. ഉച്ചഭാഷിണിയെ നമഹ പൂര കമ്മിറ്റി പ്രസിഡന്റ് കിണറ്റിൽ വീണു നടു നാലായൊടിഞ്ഞു അലമുറയിട്ട് വിളിച്ചിട്ടും ദൈവം പോലും കേട്ടില്ല ഉച്ചഭാഷിണിയിൽ ഡപ്പാങ്കൂത്ത് കത്തിക്കയറുന്നു നേരത്തോട് നേരം എത്തും മുമ്പേ പ്രസിഡന്റ് കൊടിയിറങ്ങി ഇറ്റ് ഇസ് എ ബിറ്റ് സർക്കാസ്റ്റിക് പോയം ഓൺ ഹൗ ദി പ്രപ്പോണൻസ് ഓഫ് ലൗഡ് സ്പീക്കേഴ്സ് ഗെറ്റ് ദംസെൽഫ് സീരിയസ്ലി എഫക്റ്റഡ് ബൈ ഇറ്റ് ലെറ്റ് മീ കം ടു ദ ടോപ്പിക് as we know that noise can be considered as a loud sound that is usually unpleasant and irritating and the relevance of the topic, loudspeakers are a vital part of day-to-day activities of religious centers. Many of the religious centers are situated in the neighborhood of residential, school, and hospital areas where noise level is highly restricted legally. But ambient air quality standards are not being obeyed by the religious center authorities though there are rules. Though the problem is suffered by all sections of society, it remains largely unquestioned due to social religious sentiments. Since it is a problem haunting all sessions, the study is highly relevant and important, and the study is first of its kind in Kerala. And as I mentioned earlier, there are many number of rules against the noise pollution, and the most important among them is Noise Pollution Regulation Control Rules 2000, which is the latest one, and it clearly is it visible, ma'am? Video?
Something is visible.
Hello. Can I continue?
Yeah.
Okay.
Yes, continue.
There are a number of rules regarding noise pollution, and it clearly restricts the noise levels in industrial area, commercial area, and residential and silent zone. And while dealing with my objectives and hypothesis, let me explain it. And to my objective of my study is to understand the consequence of noise pollution faced by people living near a religious center, and to find out how do the people of neighborhood of respondents perceive the noise pollution from religious center, and to find out how far the orders regarding noise pollution are being obeyed by the religious center authorities with regard to usage of mode of mic system and decibel prescribed, and to identify whether people are more prone to express their dissatisfaction to the religious center of their own or others. Okay, then move on to the hypothesis. There are 5 hypotheses are there. People are reluctant to take action against the religious center if they violate the noise pollution regulations, and fear of being isolated from society and community is a major reason why people do not complain against the noise pollution. And third one, major response of religious center authorities is to the complaints is to accuse the victim. And people who express dissatisfaction in any means face social exclusion. Complaints against noise pollution from leisure centers given in police station often go in vain. And these are my five hypotheses, and the former was my four objectives. And the methodology, ma'am, any problem?
No.
Then my methodology is, while dealing with the methodology, the concept of pollution, noise, impact, neighborhood, and all. And area of study is neighborhood of leisure center. School used this interview schedule. Pilot study was conducted. And since it is a very sensitive topic and people are not ready to open up their express their opinions regarding noise pollution, I adopted an online data collection for the research. And the variables are religion and health issues. And while going to my findings of the research, I found that 73% of the total respondents are dissatisfied with this heavy noise pollution. And the major problems they face are, especially with regard to the academics of their children or students, the main problem they mentioned are less concentration, headache, tension, and poor performance in examination. Then while psychological issues are also mentioned, it is also constitutes 73% of the total respondents. And they said that lack of sleep, hypertension, lack of interest to work, bad mood, memory loss, and depression. And it is very pathetic to understand that psychologically ill are those people who live near a religious center, which is entitled to give the psychological support to the people. It is an important finding, I think, is mine. And while dealing with the issues of senior citizen, it also very much pathetic to know that the sleeplessness, hypertension, anxiety, lifestyle diseases, etc., are very high in the people living near the religious center. And while dealing with my second objective, how the perception of neighborhood of respondents. And I think not only my respondents, the neighborhood of the respondents are also dissatisfied, but they remain silent because of the social religious sentiments. As we know that a family is composed of at least two people in minimum. So more than seven dissatisfied families in the neighborhood means that more than 14 people on an average are dissatisfied. And among the 42 respondents who replied that their neighbors are dissatisfied, 15 respondents said that 3 to 5 families are dissatisfied. And this is another important finding. And mode of while dealing with the mode of mic system, as we all know that noise pollution regulation control rules only accept box mics for announcements, but in reality, horn mics are heavily used along with the box mics, which is very pathetic and it is very much problematic to the health of people. And frequency of sound, as I mentioned earlier, in the residential area, the prescribed decibel is 45 and 50. 55 is the ambient air quality standard, but it is completely being violated all over Kerala, especially almost 75% of people live near religious center, which is 80 to 100 dB is their sound decibel they mentioned. While dealing with the hypothesis analysis, my first hypothesis is that people are reluctant to take action to the religious center if they violate the law, but it was proved false. People are ready to give complaint to the religious center because of the heavy noise. That is almost 83.83% of people given complaints. And the reason for not giving complaints is marked as a major reason for not given complaint to the religious center is fear of being isolated from society and community, which is followed by fear of being separated from relatives, fear of being threatened by the religious center committee and all. Then what is the reply of the religious center committee or religious center authority to the complaints, which is orally or written given, is accusing the victim, accusing the petitioner, that saying that you are the only petitioner and high demand of there's a high demand for increasing volume and please adjust with the committee and high dB sound is demanded by the majority. These are the major replies they give. And while dealing with the third hypothesis, that is a kind of discrimination they suffer, social stigma, social exclusion, and isolation is a major problem the persons who give their complaint, either orally or written, to the religious center. And the other important pathetic fact is that current status of complaints of police station about the noise pollution is that it is only 5.1% of the total respondents given complaints were solved. It is shows that our bureaucracy is still on the very poor path. It is not standing in with the problems of the people and the environment as a whole. And I think the recommendations are stringent implementation. We have enough laws regarding noise pollution, which is an important part of environmental pollution, and stringent implementation of the law, that is Noise Pollution Regulation Rules 2000. awareness regarding public awareness is an important way to make people aware about the health effect, health impacts or social psychological issues regarding it. We have to understand that if a complaint arises with regard to noise pollution from a religious center, naturally a person will approach the police station and give the complaint. But the policemen have no right to check the decibel. They have no the decibel checker with them. So they have to approach the state pollution control board for that. So there is a large number of lagging of time. So I think the police officers, each police station should have a decibel checker to know the prescribed decibel and if there is any violation of the law and all. And it should be part of curriculum that noise pollution is an important and analyzed. And I'm sure that there is a limitation of my studies that I cannot conduct a field work because the topic is very much sensitive and people are not ready to respond to my questions, even though they are sufferers. And it is very much sensitive issue also. And to conclude, I will say that since lockdown restrictions on religious centers are removed, the issue is again back. That is back again. And I think it is a noise pollution from religious centers. It's a very narrow topic from the topic of noise pollution. It is an ecological and social issue at the same time. And the solution rests in society, which will benefit the environment and humans at the same time. Thank you. Thank you.
Okay, thank you, Ms. Kobita.
Thank you, sir.
So your paper, I think, is a product of contemplated effort. Noise pollution
Yes,
is become a hazardous problem at present, not only in Kerala, but all over the India, I think.
Yes, sir.
And certainly the religious concern is a sensitive issue, and which we can't unlock at this moment. And certainly, as you mentioned, that the decibel, the loudspeaker used in the religious functions, there should have a prescribed intensity of sound that is affixed by the authority under some decibels, that is a tolerable decibel. Certainly, it is a very good paper. And if you insert some data regarding this noise pollution, effect of noise pollution, then certainly it will be a very good one. I think we'll do much more work, particularly upon this particular aspect, and it will open up a new dimension in thinking and also our social consciousness level. Okay, thank you, Ms. Kobita.
Thank you.
So if anybody has any question, then you may raise the question here.
Hello.
Hello. Have you any question? Yes. Have you any question? Sir, may I proceed next?
You may proceed for the next one.
Okay. Now I would like to invite Suraj Kumar Day.
Hello, ma'am.
Suraj Kumar Day, Department of Botany, Madhav Chaudhury College, Barpeta, Assam.
Hello, ma'am. I am audible.
Yeah, you are audible. Please continue your presentation.
Hello everyone, I am going to present my presentation on topic of coal mining activities and oil leakage pollution lead to environmental degradation in Northeast India, with special reference to that UN Committee's observation.
Oh my gosh.
Land communities are geographically distributed worldwide and are of tremendous importance to humankind. Lands are the heart of the nature. They provide us food, they save us from the hazardous conditions like environmental pollution, toxicity, and environmental degradations. But various anthropogenic activities or human activities destroy the plant communities and make the environment unsuitable for living. according to the World Bank's latest data, 2.1 billion tons of the waste was generated in 2019 year worldwide due to the rapid industrialization and urbanization. Management of such huge waste become a problem all over the world, as the toxic waste harm the nature and make the environment hazardous for living. Northeast India had witnessed the such environmental degradation due to the rapid urbanization and industrialization. Northeast India is known for its the plant diversity and richness in the medicinal and economically valued plant communities. The plant communities are rich in the flavonoids, alkaloids, which not only boost our immune system, but also explore pharmaceutical applications. But this rich biodiversity is in danger due to the exploitation as well as their habitat destructions in the name of the industrialization and urbanization. Coal mining and oil industrial pollutions are among the major causes of the environmental degradations in the Northeast India. Although such industries boost our economy, their extraction and transportation processes pose a major threat to the environment in general and plant communities in particular. This paper deals with the issues related to the oil and coal extraction and its harmful effects in the Northeast regions of our country. Coal mining leads to the environmental degradation in Northeast India. Coal mining, as we all know, the coal mining is the process of extracting the coal, and coal is generated for the energy purposes. In India, yearly, recently, the 600 and more than 600 tons of the coal is extracted, and it boosts our economy with the more than one lakh crore rupees. Northeast India is one of the major contributor of the coal productions at present. And Assam, Meghalaya, and Nagaland, Arunachal Pradesh are the major states for extraction of coal. There are the two methods of the coal extractions: underground mining, that is also known as the rat hole mining, and open cast mining. The majority of the coal mines in the Northeast India is open cast mining method. These are the two pictures showing the open cast coal mining in the Lido regions, and the below picture showing the rat hole minings or the underground minings in the Meghalaya of the East Jayantia Hills district. Effect of coal mining on plant community and the environment. The Northeast India coals have the abnormal toxic and the physicochemical compositions like the high sulfur, volatile matter, bertonite, and the low ash content. As it has the high sulfur content, the drainage from the coal mines not only pollute the land surfaces, but also lead to the acid mine drainages, which is harmful to plants and animals and also for the humans. The picture shows the acid drainage from the coal mine. The acid mine drainage causes the reduction of the soil fertility from the aquatic ecosystem and degrade the landmass up to the which drain is extended. Open cast mining is harmful than the rat hole mining in the Tirap of the Arunachal Pradesh due to the open cast coal mining activities cause the major damage and increase the toxicity to the environment, which leads to the harsh effect on plant communities. Plants which are found in the huge numbers in the other normal conditions, but starts disappearing in the harmful or the contaminated sites due to the environmental pollution and the degradation. The forests are cleared and were wiped out due to the in the name of the coal extractions, and huge loss of the biodiversity and the plant communities occurs of the plant communities like the endangered species plants like Adiantum, Hediotis, Ophiogyra, and Acanthera. Some of the species like the Amaranthus, Cynodon, Osimum, Desmodium, Solanum, Cypress, Acacia, Bombax, Ficus are among the indigenous plant species affected due to the coal mining activity. Few of the species like the Azadirachta indica, Mimosa pudica, which are highly tolerable to these harsh conditions and can survive in these harsh conditions, and also can be used for the remediation purposes of contaminated sites. Oil leakage pollution lead to the environmental degradation in Northeast India. Oil spills is the release of the liquid petroleum carbon in the environment, especially the marine ecosystem, due to the human activity, and is a form of the pollution. India generates the billions of the rupees and boosting its economy by extracting the oils after the coal industry, oil industry is the one of the most pollutant generating industry in the Northeast India. Oil consists of various petrochemical components which are toxic enough to degrade the environment and make the environment hazardous for living. Oil pollution harms large water bodies and harm the aquatic organisms and the ecosystem by implying the water pollution. Oil is highly flammable. If it gets into the blowout, it can burn the surrounding forest or the environment, generate black smoke, which is resulting in the air pollution. The effect of oil pollution on the plant community and the environment. Northeast India is the largest reservoir of the plant community, as I already discussed. It has the plant communities of the high value of the medicinal and the economic value. Oil industrial waste are the most toxic chemicals which directly dispose into the water bodies, resulting in the various severe diseases like the cancer. Oil pollution destroys the soil fertility, enhance the deforestation, enhance toxicity in the environment by the water and air pollution, destroy the biodiversity by burning them and release the toxic gases. Due to lack of the proper management of the waste, toxic waste, the various plant communities are start disappearing in the affected site. Recently, the oil well at the Baghjan of Assam had blowout and leaking gas, which resulting the massive fire and air pollution damage to the wetlands and biodiversity. Few days back, the Assam's Buridihing River caught fire and following a crude oil spill from an Oil India Limited pipeline in the area. This type of incidents occurs due to the illegal extraction of the oil by the leaking the Oil India Limited pipelines in the area. So such illegal extraction should be stopped by the government, and for this, the social awareness is much required. Some of the species like the Albizia vitex, Dahlia, Cyperus, Eleuthine, Euphorbia are the most indigenous plant species which are got affected due to the oil pollution. The cultivation of plants in the crude oil contaminated soil has shown the decrease in the chlorophyll pigments in the plant's body. With the increase in the concentration of the crude oil in soil decrease, the chlorophyll content of plants like the Cyperus brevifolius. Few plant species like the Cyperus mimosa pudica, Ageratum conigeus, Cymbopogon winterianus can tolerate the harsh conditions and can also be used for the remedial purposes of the contaminated sites. In conclusion, I want to say that the various due to the various activities of the human always try to play with the nature, and but we are just a part of the nature. We can't manipulate the nature. Nature always warns us by various pandemic conditions which are none other related to the human intervention and manipulations. We require more and more people like Jadav Payang, and we need to move towards the sustainable method of development. Activists say the enforcement is lax because it is coal money that funds the elections and runs the state machinery. Such serious environmental degradation problems can be solved by taking the socio-political measures. Socio-political means the social awareness, and the politically means government rules and guidelines. Government rules and guidelines can only be implemented when the people are socially aware. Recently, we've clearly seen in the Dihin Patkai protest, due to its government need to be stop the mining process and discuss on it whether mining is required or there is a happening any investigation is started. If there is illegal or unlimited or unethical mining is occurred or not. So such measures should be taken, and such protests should be more required. Through the remediation and enrichment planting are recommended to support the recovery process of the vegetation in the polluted area. To control such environmental conditions, we can must find some the alternative renewable source of energy which have the lesser effect on the environment, such as sunlight. Thank you. And last, I would like to thanks to the universities who are including the environmental science as a part of their course to aware the youth about the various environmental prospects. And I also like to thank the organizing committee of the webinar to give us a chance for make our lockdown time a productive time. Thank you.
So thanks, Mr. Suresh Kumar Day, for your nice presentation. Your paper is a very interesting one, and you selected it at the based on prime present situation or present crisis, which is going on in the Upper Assam region, particularly in the Pakistan area. But I think you get some data, particularly how much area is affected and what amount of floral and faunal species are already lost, right? So such database will certainly improve your standard of the paper.
I collected some data about the unpolluted sites and the polluted sites, how the organisms behave, and about their diversity. But I can't give all the because it will be a very large presentation then. So I concluded in the minimum. I try to conclude.
No, you have to scope to develop some models also. You have to scope to develop some models. The area of influence. Area of influence as a result of coal mining, open cast mining, underground mining, or oil spilling, whatever it may be, but you may develop some models, and models will elaborate much more information, particularly for all the readers, right? So you try to develop this way, but your paper is very interesting one because you also use a very sensitive topic, which is very serious concern at this present moment for the people of Assam particularly. Thank you, Mr. Suresh.
Sir, okay, I have a query about my paper. Okay. If I want to submit a paper, sir, there is any guideline about the length of the paper, that minimum length of the paper must be this, or more than this will be not accepted?
That will be affixed by the organizer or by the publishers. They will certainly 5,000 words, 10,000 words. So such limitations are already declared about the limitations. So you see, if you are interested to publish a paper, then certainly you contact with the publishers, then they will certainly direct you the length of the paper, the numbers of words of the papers, right? Okay, Mr. Day, please go. Thank you.
Thank you, sir.
Okay. Okay.
Any queries? If any queries on this paper, you may raise your hands and ask the question, ask the queries to Mr. Suresh Kumar Day. So if no query at all, then please proceed on for the next paper.
Srinivas Reddy.
Yeah, madam, I am present here. So shall I, I'm ready, madam. Now shall I present my PPTs?
Yes, you can.
Yeah, thank you, madam. Thanks a lot. I will start now. Yeah, is it visible, madam?
Yes.
Yeah, shall I now proceed? And very good afternoon, all of you. I'm very great opportunity for presentation of my data that is related to environmental radioactivity. First of all, I'm Srinivas Reddy, working in Department of Physics as assistant professor. The college is Mahatma Gandhi Institute of Technology, Hyderabad, which is in Telangana state. So, as per the earlier instruction from the organizers in the webinar, in the WhatsApp or some Telegram channel, so I prepared very concise data so that I can complete within 7 to 8 minutes only. So, First of all, this particular data that what I have attempted is belong to my research data in a small area. First of all, it's a very small part of my research data. So environmental radioactivity in the granite area. So environmental degradation and disaster is a theme of this present platform. So as a part of it, I feel that this is one of the significant influence of the radioactivity phenomenon in the field of degradation of environmental issues. So first of all, here, this is a natural background gamma radiation is an elevated concept in my presentation. It's a small concept in my data. So here, natural background gamma radiation in the environment. So here, it's a feature, it's an environmental feature, which is unavoidable characteristic in the phenomenon. And since the inception of the universe, this particular attribution, whatever we have, so that is unavoidable characteristic. So the mitigation and remedial measures from this particular radiation. So basically, this is a radiation which is of ionizing nature. So it is a hazardous related phenomenon. So that's why the people must be aware of it, and we have to get rid of the hazardous issues which are caused by this particular natural radiation. So it is a low-level radiation. It's not like electromagnetic radiation. It's a nuclear radiation, or we can say low-level radiation or environmental radioactivity. The radiation which is because of the environmental radioactivity phenomenon. So here, this particular low-level or environmental radiation is contributed in many number of ways. So if you see that this is the significant portions of the effects by the radiation in so many ways. Cosmic radiation, it is a cosmic radiation is there in the universe, or we can say this is a cosmic radiation which is generated in the atmosphere, which is far away from the environment. And terrestrial means it is because of the granite or mud areas or geographical features or building materials, what we are using, because of that also some effects are there in the radiation exposure. And also radon and progeny. Radon is this poisonous gas. This is generated or emanated through the soil or geological formation. So that is a radon gas is there. And potassium is also one of the radioactive content that is present inside the various types of the rocks and the geographical formation, or it may be present everywhere in the soil also. So based on the feature or property of that particular geographical location, the content may be less or sometimes it may be more. So that is potassium content is also one of the basic cause for the contribution of this radioactive exposure. And uranium and thorium in the body. Basically, our human body is also having a little bit amount of uranium, thorium in this low level. So that may also sometimes, based on the resistivity of the body, it may show a considerable effect, or it may at low level effect. So, and also one more thing, atmospheric weapons, which is testing. So nuclear weapons are going to be tested. Yeah, that also maybe because it leads to a major contribution of the pollutant, radioactive pollutants in the environment. And also one more thing is the medical area. This is a medical means, so these drugs are going to be manufactured in the industry, and so many, because of these drugs also there is a little bit contribution in the environmental radioactivity. And also one more thing, there are two types of exposures of environmental radioactivity, that is external exposure and also internal exposure. So what is external exposure? Because of this terrestrial gamma radiation. So the gamma radiation which is being emanated from the rocks, granite rocks or various building materials we are using in the construction, or many things are there in the environment, geographical features, some emanation of the gamma radiation is also there. So that causes this particular external exposure. So the radiation which is incident directly on the skin of our body, and it will undergo some ionizing phenomena, that some tissues on the surface of the skin will be damaged. So this leads to some health hazardous issues. Of course, the record of these particular issues in the India are very less when compared to other foreign countries. But of course, even though we should be more careful and aware of this particular phenomenon, so, and this is an external radiation or external exposure, we can say. Now, and one more thing, internal exposure is also there. How the internal exposure? So internal exposure is nothing but some radioactivity elements which are already in the ground level, water ground level, ground water level, and some food what we are taking in vegetables or something what we are inhaled, some we are inhaling some air. In that air also, some in microscopic level, some radioactivity elements may also be there. Those when we are breathing inside, so what happens? They will get deposited in the internal body and lungs. They have a lot of chances to get deposited in the lungs area, and internal tissues are going to be damaged. So this is also one chance of internal exposure. So breathing and taking the food in this way, so internal exposure may be caused, and also external exposure, as we have said just now. So the basic phenomenon of this radioactive phenomenon in a broad sense, on basic level, here this is a radioactivity atom, and some atom is going to be emitted to get stability. And in that particular one, radiation will be a result. This radiation will be the resultant phenomenon. So this is a radiation sometimes based on the situation or property of the element. This can be a gamma radiation, or this can be alpha radiation, something like that. It's a broad, in a broad way, I'm saying that this is a way in which the radiation is going to be emitted. So why this particular particle will come out from this particular parent atom to get the stability that everybody knows in the basic level. So here, there are, in this, based on this particular mechanism, there are various chances of emission of gamma and alpha radiations into the environment. So uranium chain is there, and thorium chain is there. So these are all the two different types of chains are there. Of course, many more nuclear chains are also there, but those are insignificant in terms of the lifetime. So the lifetime of the other nuclear chains, that may be niptium, nipton, or something like that. So those are very neglected, they are of negligible lifetime. So that's why we cannot expect the considerable hazardous health effects from those other nuclear chains. But here thorium is a 4-3, thorium is there. So that is also a considerable lifetime in the order of minutes. And the thorium, uranium is also there from this. Radon gas is coming out, so it is a 2 to 3 days approximately, this is a lifetime whenever it is active. So when we breathe or it is getting exposed to on the skin, so there is a chance of some health hazardous issues because of this particular radiation. So these are the way, this just to have introduced what is the possibility of nuclear radiation and environmental radioactivity phenomena. So here in my data, it's a small part of my research data. So I have located one district in the Telangana state in India, Karimnagar district. So especially the reasons for selecting this particular district is, which is because of the high concentration of granite. So granite concentration is more. So I'm interested to investigate the features or the special points that may be expected from the other when compared to other locations which are at less granite area. So relatively I found a little bit higher levels of radiation levels in the particular Karimnagar district where granite area is more. So and in that particular district, granite quarries are also regular operations. Granite quarries is a mining, is a granite mining, or we can say granite quarries. So that is also radioactive dust. Radioactive dust in the air is also going to be emanated. And I'm interested to investigate the effect of this particular radioactive dust because of this granite area. How it will be, that is in my study. So here, already we place to place this particular radiation within the Karimnagar district or in other locations, it definitely varies from place to place. The variation of this particular radiation from place to place depends on many features. So the geographical formation or the ventilation condition or some life style of habitats. That means human beings are of different habits of living style. So based on that also, this particular radiation levels may have their significant in the contribution. So here, this is a Karimnagar district where it is here 45 degrees temperature to 50 degrees temperature, 15 to 45 degrees temperature variation is there, and high granite location and where granite mining is a regular activity. So these are the basic information about the my study area. So here in the investigation of my research study, we used some methods and instruments. The few are I am now going to reveal. Thermoluminescence dosimeter. So dosimetry is nothing but it is a phenomenon of estimating the dose of the radiation. That is what the dosimetry. So thermoluminescence dosimetry, we have installed this particular instruments in the various residential areas and open areas also. And also micro survey meter. So that is also one of the significant instruments that we are implementing to estimate the natural background radiation level. So these are the two things. Along with these two, and we have also implemented one more the technique, that is twin chamber cup dosimeter, where two elements are going to be traced out, radon and thoron. Radon is a daughter product. Radon is a gas which is emanated in the uranium, and thoron is a element which is emanated in the thorium series. So three different experimental approaches we have implemented in the this particular study. I now particularly in this present presentation, I am interested to elevate a simple point that granite area, why this will have the basic reason of contributing more environmental radioactivity this particular granite area is uranium, thorium and potassium. These are the three radioactive elements which are present in the granite areas actually. So those are the basic sources of emitting the gamma rays. So potassium is significant emit more gamma rays. So that's why the what we have observed in the study is the gamma radiation in this particular thing. And now we are just we have seen the various seasonal variations also, how the our recordings in the different seasons, autumn and winter, summer, rainy. So relatively we have got a little bit more in winter. So why? Because in the residential environment, in the winter, most of the time the doors and windows are remains closed. So because of that, there is no ventilation, and whatever the gas that is emanated from the dust and from the wall also, from the floor also, from the flooring and wall, these are all the things that contain some radioactive elements. So those are emanating the radioactive gases. So those are accumulates because of no ventilation. So because of that, it may be the reason of relatively maximum levels in the winter season. So that we have observed. And also this bare mold, concrete, granite, marble and limestone. These are the different elements that we have investigated. Relatively, of course, we got maximum value in the limestone as a flooring element. And granite is also relatively higher. Of course, in this particular, this is a data which shows, which is obtained in our primary studies. So here, this complete data, we have statistically summarized also, arithmetic mean, what is the micro gray per year is 1567. So these are all the values which are below the international standard values. So the of course, the whatever the area that we have selected in the measurement of gamma radiation levels are safe zone only, as per the regulations of international commissions. So these are the maximum minimum data and indoor to outdoor ratio in the environmental outside and in the inside the house, what are the comparisons? So that we have also statistically find out, and this particular statistical data will reveal that outside environment, the radiation levels are very less when compared to the inside environment. So this is the data that we have found, and next, these are the references that we have seen. And one more thing, here conclusions, relatively higher values are observed in granite area in our research data, and various dwellings or houses we have selected. The moreover, average higher values are observed in the old houses, and in new houses, average data is found to be at minimum level. And also, it is observed that closed residential environment will record more values. That may be because of poor ventilations, or and also the houses which are constructed with mud walls in the old old residential places, mud walls are there. So the mud may have the high content of radioactive elements. That may be the reason for recording of a little bit higher values of gamma radiation. And what are the remedies for this particular one? So the we have investigated a lot of literature, and we have looked into the literature, and our the database. So we have we are interested to reveal some advices that buildings with good ventilation is recommended to reduce the effect of this particular radiation, and also the usage of materials of radioactive, high radioactive content, whatever is there, that should not be used in the construction activity. Of course, we will come to know if you investigate or if you study the database is more nowadays, which materials are of less radioactive elements, something like that. The materials which are having more radioactive elements, which are very dangerous, which may cause a lot of radioactive risk. And also, the public or population should have the awareness of the radioactive risk. This is also one of the advices that we are interested to reveal from this particular study. And now here, I'm very happy, and I'm very grateful to our principal and management of our college. And also, this opportunity is given by Department of Geography, Barala College, Jorhat, Assam. And CDC, Dibrugarh University. So I am very much thankful to you for all organizers of this particular event. I feel very proud to be one among this particular participants. I'm very grateful to you, sir. Thank you, madam.
So thanks, Mr. Srinivas, for your much more informative presentation, paper presentation. I think it will do some beneficial for particularly in your areas, which is suffering by the effect of radioactivity. When you talk about the environmental radioactivity, you need to include the effect of ultraviolet radiation.
Okay.
Ultraviolet radiation, it is also increasing because that ozone hole, Antarctica. And before lockdown, there was under ozone hole in the North Pole, right?
Yeah. Yes, sir.
So that's why the ultraviolet radiation is entering into the Earth atmosphere and also affect the entire living creatures here, right?
Yes, sir. Yes.
So thereby, you need to include that particular aspect also in your
definitely,
study.
Sir. Definitely, sir. Definitely.
Okay. But anyway, your attempt, your process, your effort is very nice one. Because
thank you, sir. Thanks a lot. Thank you, sir.
Okay. Thank you, sir. Mr. Nivas.
Thank you, sir. Thank
now
you.
Now your paper is released in the session for discussion.
Thank you, sir. Thank you.
So any queries you may ask to Mr. Reddy. Hello. Any queries from anybody?
I think no, sir.
If not, then proceed for the next.
Mr. Reddy, please you close your screen. Mr. Reddy, please close your screen.
Yeah.
Thank you. So this was our last paper. So I want to know, anybody interested to present paper now? Please raise your hand. I want to know anybody interested to present paper now?
From one person raising his hand.
Your name is not visible, only your mobile name is visible. So please,
please unmute, sir. Okay.
Just take it, sir.
Hello.
Hello.
Hello. Yes. Good afternoon, all of you. Good afternoon, all of you. I of the whole team, organization team, I want to thank you that I got a chance to present the paper. I do not take much time speaking in my topic. Thank you. The direct impact of environment is directly related of animals, trees, plants, and human life. The whole world is going through a terrible human tragedy, COVID-19, which is a contagious disease combined with the government of India and the state government of prevent it. Under the aegis, a nationwide lockdown was declared from 23 March, which is being maintained by every person of the country with full devotion. This lockdown itself has adverse effect on the economy of all countries, but it also saw a ray of hope. The environment will definitely provide positive impact. We are considering the same issue that due to environmental degradation, the air has started to purify. All the time the sky is black with smoke, blue is visible, the stars are shining at night, and the air pollution at the intersection of the major cities of the country. It is a very good sign for nature that due to lockdown, environmental is declining and there is a hug decline in air, water and noise pollution in the country. At the same time, there are signs of improvement in the ozone layer as well due to the sudden drop in pollution levels worldwide. The ozone layer was also positively affected. The ozone layer has also found a place of breath with vehicles and people alert to their movement on the roads. We can say that the action of the world has made this different. And in the coming time, full treatment of the ozone layer may be possible. The way positive effect have been seen in the whole world in nature and environment after lockdown. Estimated experiments come out that by creating a solid policy, the balance of nature can be maintained by voluntarily downgrading the profit in different cities of at least 15 days or 1 month, 1 year. As you may be aware that fasting has an important in India culture. Scientifically, during fasting, our body cleanses itself by which the digestion of the body is crude. Similarly, keeping the lockdown in the ear and provide an opportunity to return an old tone to nature and environment, not only but the world. We have got positive effect due to environment degradation due to lockdown. The following are the positive effect of environment degradation, such as in the lockdown, road transport, trains and air travels are all closed, due to which people who are where they have to face trouble. But in the meantime, nature is now breathing freely. According to NASA, the aerosol level in India has been the lowest measured in the last 20 years, due to which the ecosystem is being balanced. The probability to equilibrium in the organization to atmosphere gases and increased manifold. Nitrogen oxide level are steadily decreasing, which is possible due to the closure of vehicle and factories. The fear of the coronavirus has also disciplined the unwanted human life that is coming out in the form of social distancing. The level of air quality has decreased of 50% during lockdown. In some areas where it was between 100 and 150, the air has already been purified. A part of from the vibration reduction has been left on the surface of the earth by 33%. Finally, I hope that in 1 or 2 months, when the impact of the epidemic in the country will be less, then nature will become even more blossom and more fragrant, and men will learn something from these changes and will learn to conserve the environment. Thank you.
So thanks for your presentation. Now I think, and my feeling is that it is a very nice paper you composed, particularly on the current situation. Right? The ozone hole that appears in the northern North Polar region, now it disappears. It appears before lockdown, and after lockdown, the entire ozone hole disappears from the North Polar region. Right? So that ozone hole that appears periodically over North Pole and South Pole, but because of the lockdown, since pollution is lost already, because I think the most pollutant is the motor vehicles.
Yes, right? Thank you.
So all over the world, if you see that, I wrote to Greta Thunberg about this particular hydrocarbon runs vehicles, that about 1 liter of diesel releases 1.6 kg of carbon dioxide. Burning of 1 liter diesel, it releases 1.6 kg of carbon dioxide. Another 1 liter of petrol burning releases 1.3 kg of carbon dioxide. If you look to the entire world, or the scenario of the world, motor vehicle scenario of the world, then certainly you would think that it is much more effective than the industrial sectors, because all through the day and night, that motor vehicles continue to run all over the world. But industries, it runs for 8 hours or for 6 hours, 7 hours. But thereby, if
motor vehicles, running of motor vehicles is stopped, burning of fossil fuel like diesel or petrol is stopped, then certainly we'll have a very clean and clear environment as you kill it, right? So thank you very much. So now
okay.
Your paper is open for discussion. So if any queries,
you may I am a paralyzed, full body and paralyzed.
I feel it. I feel it. Yes. Excellent. I see you. So okay, then any queries, then certainly they will raise. I will get it.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you. So any queries? From the organizers? Rana?
No. Yeah.
Sir.
Any questions from audience, spectators?
Oh, let's go out again.
If there is any query, please raise your hands, please.
So if no question, then proceed for the next.
Okay, sir.
Sir, Sataksi sent a message. She writes that I was unable to present PPT. I would like to present my paper verbally. Sir, is it possible now for another paper?
If you permit, it is up to you, not on me, depend on me.
Rana, is it possible?
If you allow, then...
Okay, one paper, we can proceed for one paper. If it is more than one paper, it will take more time, actually.
More time.
Oh, yeah.
So if there is any more than one, then you don't miss.
Next day session is also, there are three sessions also there next day.
Okay. Then
if one paper is there, then you can proceed, no problem.
Sataksi, if you want to present paper, then continue your paper.
Hello.
Yes.
Yes, thank you, ma'am. I was trying for such a long time. Actually, I was dealing with some technical issues. That's why I was unable to present the paper. So, and still I am not able to present my PPT. So I would like to read out my paper verbally. Thank you so much for giving me another chance. So the title of my paper is Human Nature. Why is it always man versus nature and not man and nature? Humans have a tendency to possess everything that the field can benefit them, be it flora and fauna or other humans just like them. Survival of the fittest was the rule given by Charles Darwin, and it is misinterpreted by us all the time. Darwin, by the word fittest, meant the being that is made to survive all the circumstances by nature itself, and not that one who tries to suppress the other forcefully. But man tries to exploit everything that he thinks is inferior to him. In ancient times, there happened to be a systematization of everything. People used to worship nature. They recognized themselves one with nature. Animals, plants, trees, oceans, rivers, everything that provided support and life force were adorned. They identified themselves one with nature and other earthly inhabitants. But the modern man lives with the ego of superiority over these entities. He has polluted the air, water bodies, cut down forests mercilessly, killed or enslaved animals recklessly. To speak frankly, he has overexploited nature resources in such a way as of being oblivious of the fact that they are limited and take time to refill. I would like to quote Madhu Mazvi. Her recent article in a journal Energy, in a science journal Energy, has acclaimed her the prestigious Watt Prize. She is a PhD student in the Faculty of Science, Technology, Engineering and Mathematics at the School of Engineering and Innovation, the Open University, Milton Keynes, UK. She says, she talks about the availability of coal as a supreme energy source and also its shortcomings. She says, coal presents a particular set of challenges when balancing energy policy goals. Despite presenting viable solutions to the problems of energy security and global energy poverty, coal struggles given its greenhouse gas drawbacks in a world of increasingly harmful climate change. We talk about recent times concerning the world. The frequency of natural as well as man-made disasters have shockingly increased. They occurred earlier too, but the frequency has significantly increased. Pandemics, like I will talk about this millennium also, and this millennium too. Pandemics like Ebola that hit the African countries, their symptoms were very much similar to COVID-19. And before that, anthrax and AIDS also played havoc when they were not curable. The 2004 tsunami that hit Indonesia, the 2015 massive seismic wave that demolished almost entire Nepal. Giving any heed to it, they have forgotten it perhaps. The prominent and most talked about issue, global warming, seems to reside in debates only. Hardly any country in the world are actually making efforts to tackle it. A rigorous increase in the temperature year by year because of the increase in the number of automobiles, industries, non-biodegradable materials are causing significant harm to the balance of the earth. Now, if we talk about India, there has been a tradition of feeling presence of God in nature since the origin of civilization. The sun, the moon, rivers, forests, all were considered to be life forces. But in recent times, we are coping up with bad air quality. The AQI goes up to like 300. Poisonous water, and that too, reducing gradually. Most of the Indian states begin to face a drought-like situation at the very early summer. The underground water level goes down and tanker services become the only aid. The capital Delhi, our country's capital Delhi, faced the same situation last year. Tanker services were taken as help to provide drinking water to people. The slum areas near the banks of the Yamuna River, along with the industrial wastes, have contaminated the river so badly that slums are visible more than water in the river. A warmer weather and lesser rain year by year, all because of the so far ignorant attitude of ours. We, because of such unthoughtful and irresponsible gesture, have invited disasters very frequently. Sir, as being a student of literature, I'd like to share with you my 100-word short story, which I had posted on momspresso.com. It's a blogging site, and you can write blogs or stories there. I had written a short story The title of the story was The Unnatural. And it goes like, the little sapling, half asleep in the cozy soil, lost in a dream of becoming a flourishing tree one day, wakes up with a touch of a dewdrop, cold but quenching. The morning sun instills energy vibes in the tiny spirit, with a promise to grow every day, survives adversity, carry life, nature's dearest being. It will dance with the wind, chat with the chirpy birds, will give the sweetest fruit flavor. Then the scenario changes. But what's that foul smell? Burning, killing it from within. A buzz in the mind, forcing. What's happening? Unwanted development, unwilling, rough, suffocating, strangulating, demonic strength, destroyed soul, poisonous throat. So this story presents the current scenario, how a natural thing is turned out to be unnatural. It is applied both on man and nature. If you look, if you take a deeper look, you can derive the meaning. Then I will move to summing up my paper by providing a few solutions that have been applied or should be applied for the betterment of the environment. The odd event formula that was recently applied in Delhi, they give positive results. It was visibly helpful in reducing the AQI, not as expected though, but yes, it helped a lot. Machines are being imported from Japan as a link to clean the trashes from the water bodies. Industrial wastes are being managed by purification processes before releasing them into the river. Water harvesting process is going on. Plantation of trees are being promoted. Conservative habits regarding daily water usage are also promoted by various schemes of the government. But over and above, human goodwill is what is the most necessary thing to conduct all these plans. Until and unless we willingly won't come to realize that what harm we are causing to nature because of our greed and misdeeds, the situation is not going to improve. Yes, it is true that after every disaster, we have the power to recollect ourselves and stand once again. But that doesn't mean that we should put the sufferings and loss we went through into oblivion. We must set up such measures so as to minimize the casualties and maximize security in the face of calamity. So that's all from my side. Thank you so much for providing me a chance.
Okay, thanks, Satakshi. How do you develop your paper?
Yes,
research methodology, research methods, database, you need to incorporate all these things, then it will be research paper, right?
Yes, yes.
Likewise, you continue your effort, certainly will come back. Okay, thank you.
Thank you so much.
So, if any queries from the audience, let me raise and ask Satakshi.
Hello.
Sir, I would like to request Bhupendranath Goswami sir to conclude the session, offering concluding views. Actually, it is already 3 p.m. now. Therefore, we'd like to conclude today's session. If there are any presenter is there, in next day, we'll include them.
Okay. Thanks, Rana.
Sorry.
So, omniscient versus the prudent competitors, multiple researchers, and honorable members of the college. I am grateful to the organizer of the seminar as they ensure my partake in the webinar even after knowing my limitation of knowledge in this most sensitive field of world concern. I have nothing new to place here for the benefit of the prudent academicians present here. Before to have an entry into the subject matter, I am intended to conclude with few words, like one word from Leopold and Miller. In 1949, Leopold Miller wrote that man was out of balance with his nature and we must soon pay the consequences. It was the warning from Leopold Miller and which we today are facing, or the entire world is facing. And secondly, in 1992, Graham Brundtland, who was present in the Rio de Janeiro Convention Art Summit, he very boldly and hopefully concluded that the library of life is on fire. We must put it out. Engels, in his Dialectics of Nature, in the early part of 19th century, he wrote, "The old ecology has profoundly been destroyed by the Western capitalism, first by through colonialism and secondly by capitalism." Right? So these are very facts, actually. So, but even then, at the last but not the least, I want to place here the green philosophy. Man must recognize the necessity of cooperating with nature. He must temper his demands and use and conserve the natural living resources of this earth in a manner that also that alone can provide for the condition for the continuation of civilization. Along with this, I want to have few words for the participants. These are my humble request to all of you present here that you do not run only after raising your API, but simultaneously you continued your all kind effort to raise the level of commitments and consciousness among common people to make our endeavor a mass concern. Only there will be found our severe effective result-oriented outcome of this seminar, right? As the seminar is solely concerned with the environmental degradation and disaster, not only in India, but all over the world, that disaster is hitting in every nook and corner. So thereby, our people consciousness is must a concern to prevent all these upcoming danger from the environmental degradation, right? So total elimination of civilization is knocking at the door, which Greta Thunberg suggested that 6 mass extinction of human civilization is facing
So thereby, if we are not concerned, if we are not conscious, then certainly we have to face the sixth mass extinction. So therefore, the very basic theme of the seminar is a most holistic one at the present time and the present situation of the world. So therefore, the participants, I request you to do not only paperworks. You need to do the groundwork to raise the consciousness level of the common people so that we can live here and make the art livable. Thank you very much. Thanks.
Thank you, sir. Thank you very much for your valuable comments and concluding very resourceful conclusion, actually, sir. Meenakshi ma'am, are you going to share anything? Hello? Any conclusion?
It's actually, the topic is a very relevant one.
Aisha.
And especially in Assam, we have all seen in the Northeast the disasters that are unfolding during this lockdown also. So I would say that Borhola College has chosen, Department of Geography has chosen a very relevant topic. And you have also organized the seminar very well, because I have heard from you that you have had 1,000 participants and 200 paper presenters. That is an immense task. And I congratulate you all.
Thank you, ma'am,
for organizing it so well. That is all. Bhupen Musami sir has already given a message to all the faculty members as well as the participants.
Okay.
I support that.
Thank you, ma'am. Thank you, ma'am. Thank you, Bhupendranath Goswami sir. Thank you, Meenakshi Phukan Hazarika ma'am, and other resource person and other dignitaries present in this online seminar, and dear participant for presenting very nice presentation. Thank you to all. And if there is any paper presenter, we'll give chance to them to present their paper on next day, because time is already over. Thank you again, sir. Like to, with these few words, we are going to conclude today's session, and most welcome for the next tomorrow session also to all of you, sir. Thank you very much, sir.
Okay.
Thank you very much, sir. Thank you all the participants. Thank you. And could you know? Could you know?